Smorgasbord Radio Show.
Come on. Almost there.
Different way of arriving.
Ah. Here. Let me hop down first. All right, here. Need a hand, Allie?
Yeah.
Come on down.
Wow, this is not our most practical way of arriving, but...
Hey.
Nice tractor.
Hey, yeah. Thank you. You like this?
Yeah, this is... Nice change of scenery here.
We'll explain here in just a minute. There's another tractor coming in now.
Yeehaw!
Hee-haw!
Hee-haw!
Jerry! Dave!
Hey! Oh, boy. I didn't think I had the right place.
You got the right place.
I said there's no way this could be where we're supposed to be.
No civilization around.
This tractor smells of manure. I don't like it.
Yeah, I saw a rattlesnake back there.
Wow.
Dolphin?
I missed
this
one.
This is definitely not your traditional smorg show. Or maybe it is, since we're just so unpredictable.
Well, let me explain. So you guys know, you remember back in the old days when we did our show from the barn in Naperville?
Yeah, there was a lot of leftover pizza, I remember.
There was. We had too many pizzas. Nobody showed up for it because it was a big snowstorm. So for this big episode, this is the Smorg Show podcast, by the way. Welcome to it. It's episode 100. I decided to do something a little special for us. I couldn't get the barn. It was all booked up for the holidays. So I got a barn. So that's where we are. It's kind of a broken down barn.
It's a bit drafty in here.
A little shabby, but it's... The shabby chic is in.
Is it?
The old rustic farmhouse look, yeah.
Oh, didn't know that.
I hope you got a discount.
I absolutely free this time. It's because it's in the family, sort of. The SmorgShow family. Remember Granny Rose?
Of course.
Yeah, of course.
She went off. I guess we'll get her story, but this is her grandson's barn.
Mm-hmm.
And she didn't live too far from the studio, so I got this for the weekend, and this is where we're doing the show today.
Great. I'm looking forward to seeing Granny Rose. It's been a long time.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, in fact, she's somewhere
She's in the house because that's a little bit cold in here with the draft, so she didn't want to be in here the whole time, but
yeah.
I know she's in the house. I think she was going to bake some cookies after the show, but I can go get her and have her give us a little introduction.
Why don't you do that, Allie? And then the three of us will just kind of kill some time here and explain what's going to be happening over the next couple of hours. And we have a lot planned. I tried to think about what we wanted to do for the 100th episode. We kicked this show off back in January of 2010, and we'll talk a little bit about that coming up. But wow, not used to these farm animals. We're going to be doing a little bit of a retrospective. We're going to be looking back on the last 8 years, and talk about some of our favorite bits. We're going to play various segments from each of the shows, but we have a lot of new things to introduce. A lot of special guests. Obviously, Granny Rose is going to be coming down here shortly. We have Baba's coming back from India, and we've also got Philip Donald, also out of prison, and he is going to be doing a live song later. But, here she is. Hey, Jerry, you want to make some room for Granny Rose? Let Granny Rose sit down.
Yes. Let me get out of the way.
Granny Rose, I love your shawl.
Oh.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
I don't think she needs headphones. You probably don't need the headphones, do you?
I don't wear those things, no. Sorry, whatever hair I have left.
You're looking good, Granny Rose.
Well, thank you. I'm feeling much better now.
I'm sorry we haven't had you back in a long time.
Well, I've been kind of busy. I had some health issues, and I had to leave my home, which was really sad. But I'm in assisted living now, and sometimes I need help. And there's no shame in that.
No.
Not at all.
No.
But I'm feeling better now.
Well, thank you for allowing us to come out to your beautiful barn to do our big episode.
Well, it's not really my farm anymore. It belongs to my grandson. He's taken over the family farm now.
It's a lovely barn.
Well, thank you. Yeah. It's been in our family for many generations, and that was one of the things that I thought maybe I might share is a few things that maybe people don't realize about farming.
Yeah, will we get to kind of look at some of the animals later, too?
Well, sure.
They're all around. You've got a couple of cows, you've got lots of chickens, got a sheep. I've heard of the sheep.
We have quite a few sheep, not as many cows anymore. I think only one or two, but we have quite a few sheep and chickens.
Yeah. So you want to share with us a little bit of farming? Honestly, I've been in the Midwest my whole life. I don't really know a lot about farming, but you guys.
Well, a lot of people don't really know that much.
Actually, I know a little bit from when I was young because my mom thought she was a farmer, and so we had a lot of farm animals.
You had a lot of farm animals at your house. It was a suburb. It was like a regular house, and you just had.
Yeah, we had goats, chickens, ducks.
Yeah. I don't think when I met you, you had them anymore, did you?
No, I think they were all pretty much slaughtered.
Great. And now you've got chickens in your apartment.
Only as friends.
I follow an Instagram page. This lady has a tame turkey living in her house with her. So anything goes nowadays.
Yeah, I've seen that Instagram. So, sorry, we interrupted you, Granny Rose. You want to tell us a little bit about what goes on around here?
Well, I just wanted to let you know that farming life is really a family affair, and this farm has been in our family since my grandparents. They started the farm, and it's been passed along from generation to generation. And when I lived on the farm as a child, there were always projects to do, and no matter how old you were, you had a job on the farm. Everybody had to pitch in and help. So farm life includes the whole family.
And what time would you have to get up in the morning?
Sometimes we got up before the sun. It depended on what the projects were. And our days were always long. Farmers rely on the sunshine. So we would have to start early and we would work until the sun was down.
I don't think people really appreciate how much work farmers do. Not only back then, but even these days.
Oh, yeah.
That's right.
Absolutely.
And weather is such a huge proponent, most people probably realize that. But have you ever heard of sayings like, make hay while the sun shines? Have you ever heard that?
Can't say that I have.
Or maybe...
Jerry's nodding yes.
Oh.
Yes, well, I have heard that phrase.
He's more cultured than all of us.
How about God willing and the creek don't rise?
Yes.
Heard that one.
I know that one.
Well, did you know that depending on the weather, it determines how things go? So weather is a big deal for us farmers.
They rely
on it for their living. And if it's too wet, the crops can't get planted or harvested. And if it's too cloudy or damp, the hay doesn't dry. And if it's too dry, then the plants won't grow. And if the grass doesn't grow, then we have to get more hay to feed the animals.
A lot of variables there.
There are. And I think one of the other things people don't realize is that I think there's this notion that a lot of people think that anyone with dirty hands isn't very smart. Well, that's just not true. My grandfather was a farmer, and he was the smartest person I ever met.
You have to be very resourceful.
Resourceful,
I would imagine.
And smart.
To be a good farmer, you have to be very knowledgeable about a lot of different things, sort of a jack of all trades.
Mm-hmm. That is true, because there's so many things that have to be done.
How many generations has this farm been handed down from your family?
Well, it's from my grandparents, so that would be
one?
Four or five generations, right?
Wow.
Because my grandson has it now.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is about five generations.
What, the mid-1800s?
I don't know. I don't remember those kinds of things anymore.
Do you think, will your grandson pass it down? And then do you think it'll keep getting passed down generation to generation?
I hope so.
Keep it alive.
I think one of the other things that people don't realize is I think so many people think that farming kind of mimics what you might read in children's books, but that's not the case anymore. Mm. When my grandparents had it, it was like that, where they had a lot of different animals and they did a lot of different things and they made a living off from all of that. But now farms have become much more specialized. So they may only have one type of animal. And farms have become much more...
technological?
Yes, thank you. I was trying to remember that word. Yes, you can't begin to know all of the technology that my grandson uses to operate the farm. It's totally different than when I was a kid.
Hmm. Yeah, but these days, I mean, farming is in the 21st century.
It is. I think he has climate-controlled barns, and he has digital things that tell him when to do stuff and when the animals need to be fed and probably things that I don't even know about.
Wow. Now, has your family been involved in organic farming, or do you use commercial fertilizers?
Well, we tried to be organic when we could.
It's more expensive that way.
It is more expensive, but we always cared about the environment and our health and everyone else's health. But it's hard. It's not an easy business.
No.
Yeah.
No. Was it when you were working on the farm, you always tried to make the animals' welfare a top priority, right?
Oh, yes, yes. We are multi-generations of people that have loved animals. We just love them.
Well, the animals look like they've been well taken care of here. They look very healthy. They look happy.
Shiny feathers.
Yeah.
Now, do you sell the milk that you every morning that you get from the cows, or do you just save that for your family?
Well, no. The cows are rescue cows, so they just live happily on the farm. But we don't send them to slaughter and they're boys, so they don't have milk. But But we do use the wool from the sheep and the eggs from the chickens.
Yeah. Well, fantastic.
So cool. So many things that we didn't know about farming.
Well,
nice to be here again. It's been a long time.
Yeah. Well, it's great seeing you. Do you have anything else for us, or was that pretty much it?
If I had anything else, I don't remember.
Okay. Well, we have about a couple of hours ahead of us, so we're just going to hang out here, if that's okay.
Oh, sure. Stay as long as you like.
Yeah, it's a little chilly out here.
Well, you can always come in for some coffee in the farmhouse, and I think there's some fresh cookies.
Okay.
Oh, so you are done with that.
There's always fresh cookies.
Yeah.
That's right. You got to have cookies and coffee on the farm.
We will be up there shortly. We've got a couple of segments to play here, and I think we'll have some time for a break, so... Good to know. We've got something to look forward to.
Well, have a lovely day, and thanks for helping me to be a part of this.
Thank you, Granny Rose.
We couldn't Great have to this, see you, Granny
yeah,
Rose.
We couldn't have this milestone event and not invite you back.
Oh, thank you.
Always great to see you, Granny Rose.
You take care of yourself now.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
By the way, the rattlesnakes, they're not supposed to be here, are they? Or because I saw some rattlesnakes.
I am not aware of rattlesnakes.
Okay, just checking. I didn't know.
Were they in the field?
Well, just right outside. Right now.
Yeah, I know. We've got a
cornfield. They tend to hang out around trees and stuff. So
I don't think I can outrun them anymore.
No. All right, thanks.
Bye.
See you soon.
Bye-bye, Granny Rose.
Well, that was nice. That was a nice welcome.
I learned a lot.
She's so cute.
So, once again, this is episode 100. But I was thinking about this when I was kind of typing up the show notes to go on the website, that next week is actually a very personal day for me. 40 years to the day that I launched my bedroom radio station, WKID.
How do you remember the date on that?
I just remember it was the first or second week of January, 1979. And it was just me, this humble little 12-year-old with a Panasonic tape recorder, little handheld microphones at a turntable, and I just played the top 40 records, announced over them, and every Saturday morning I would do that for a couple of hours, and I did that for the next couple of years until I got into high school and, of course, got into radio, and the rest is history. But
now everybody did that, right? Because I did that.
You did it too?
I used to do that too. That's how I learned how to talk up the intros.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You learned how to ad-lib.
How'd you learn how to do that?
Hey, how do you do that?
Yeah. I was always impressed with the perfect timing where a song starts playing and they're talking over the introduction. And yeah. then as soon as they stop talking, that's when the singing happens.
That's right.
I'm always amazed by that.
That's Do they still do that?
Oh,
Back then it was all intuition and feeling. Now you have a clock. It tells you how many seconds you have left before the vocal starts. Before
you, it seems like it's a craft. You got to master that.
It used to be.
And so, the term is called hitting the post.
Hitting the post.
Hitting the post. And you did that even if you weren't familiar with the song. There was some sort of a skill that you knew. Just based on the intro, you just knew when it was going to start. I don't know how to describe it, but me generally had to know this.
I think part of it was is that they probably were going to they hit the post at a certain point, and they could feel that the music would still keep going, and they'd find a way of just sort
extending it
to make it sound like they were. Hey, I know that.
Throwing the time and temp.
Throwing the time, the temp.
Yeah, you got the time and the temp. If you need an extra couple of seconds, you got
the contest coming up next hour.
Oh, that's right. The phone number, radio station phone number.
But I still think it's more difficult than what it seems because it's two different parts of the brain, the music side of your brain and the talking part of your brain, which is why it's easier to sing and play guitar than to talk and play guitar. It's really it's like two different parts of the brain. So if you're talking during the intro of a song and trying to feel out it's like you're really using both parts of your brain that way.
Yeah.
Who said DJs are stupid?
That would have been my career. That was what my goal was. Okay, so here's what we're going to do. We've got this show divided up into four segments. Five, if you count the outro. But out of the 100 episodes, this is 100, out of the 99 previous episodes, I've divided up into groups of 25. And I took anywhere between 10 seconds and a minute from each show. Mm-hmm. And I just spliced them together. And they're separated by a Q tone, so you'll know when one ends and one goes into the next one. And we're just going to play the first collage now, which will be the first 25 episodes. So looking at my notes here, this goes back to January 30th, 2010, all the way through July 25th, 2010. Allie and I had just kicked this new podcasting hobby off. We had no idea what we were doing. I was learning as I went along the way. We had very humble recording equipment, even at the earlier shows. So you'll start to see, I hope you'll start to see some evolution in how we've kind of progressed over time as we go through these. And
you know, you're talking about how it's been 40 years since you launched your radio program, but I can't believe it's been just about 9 years since we were upstairs in the kitchen just playing around with this thing.
Yeah, I had no idea that this was going to evolve.
Right, and you know, back then it was like, oh, wow, it's been 25 years since the original radio show when you were in high school and everything, but it's like, man, it's been 9 years since then. So it's like funny we're looking back on something when we were looking back on something before. So
yeah,
it's kind of weird and kind of funny that episode 100 is happening like around that, getting within the month of when we first started this thing.
Yeah, if we had done this on a weekly basis, we would have hit episode 100 after 2 years. But you'll notice like the first year it was religiously every week we had one. And then the second year, I think we went every other week, and then we went to every third or fourth week, and then
and
it just
fizzled
out.
And then it went on a when we feel like it basis.
Yeah. But this year, I really feel good because Dave and Jerry have come back, and you've been on every show in the '90s here. So because Allie, you've gone off to school, and it's been more sporadic that we've been able to do something.
Hmm.
So here we go. Let's go back to this is about 11 minutes to get through this next bit, but let's kick back with some coffee and enjoy episodes 1 through 25 on the Smork Show podcast. Hello, Allison. Please come in.
Hi, how's it going?
Hey, it's good. This is my daughter.
Hello.
Almost 12 years old now.
My birthday's in a month.
You want to be called Allie or Allison?
Either one's fine.
Well, this is is a new medium for you, so this is the way you start your new identity, I guess.
Yeah, I guess I'll be called Allie, because that's usually my nickname that everyone calls me, so hi, I'm Allie.
Hi, Allie, nice to meet you. This game is called What Did I Say? It's basically a message that's played backwards, and you have to figure out what it says going forward.
I have no idea.
Oh, come on, you've got to know that. It's boob!
That's what you are.
I want you to do it again,
as fast as you can so that it shows that you're not really reading it, okay?
All right. Washington, Adams, Jefferson, Madison, Monroe, Adams, Jackson, Harrison, Taylor, Polk, Taylor, Pembroke, Pekin, and Lincoln, Johnson, Grant, and Hayes, Garfield, Delta, Cleveland, Harrison, McKinley, Roosevelt, Tufts, Wilson, Harden, Coolidge, Shriver, Roosevelt, Truman, Eisenhower, Kennedy, Johnson, Nixon, Ford, Carter, Reagan, Clinton, Bush, Obama.
There you go.
Everybody, it's time again for the most romantic game in podcast history. It's the dating game.
Happy birthday, Ellie.
Hey,
it's Baba.
It's Baba.
Oh, this is Baba Ganesh calling you all the way from Delhi, India.
Oh, wow.
I'm sorry I could not be there to celebrate your special day with you in person, but I am here in India celebrating our annual holy festival.
Then the pig rolled in the mud. And in elephant's dung, and all the other rubbish he could find. And then he went to go meet the beggar.
Okay, for the next question. You are invited to a meal at a French person's home. Snails, which revolt you, are served as the entree. Do you, A, force yourself to eat them, saying nothing, B, refuse them point blank, or C, tactfully acknowledge your
gastropodic?
Gastropodic
virginity, and so, say you will try one, but...
Okay. We gotta do that over.
No, it's fine.
Well, it's nice to be some kind of a virgin anyway.
Tortue or to eschew?
Or eschew.
We got to start over.
You said this wasn't a French test.
Smorg Show Theater presents Murder in the Mansion.
I'm in desperate trouble.
I'm sorry. I cannot hear you. Please speak louder.
Sharon Osbourne, wife of rock star Ozzy Osbourne, is planning to have her breast implants removed and intends to give one of them to her husband, Ozzy, for him to use as a paperweight. The 57-year-old is reportedly fed up with her 34 double D chest, telling friends that she's too old for a massive bust.
We will continue this interview after Philip sings a song for us. So go ahead, and we're moving over to Studio D. And Philip, warm up and get ready to sing for us.
I really appreciate you all listening to me tonight when I present to you a song that I wrote called Such a Good Ugly Thing. Hope you like it.
Question number 4. In which month do Russians celebrate the October Revolution?
November.
Very good.
Oh, that was just a lucky guess.
You deserve one of these.
I was just guessing because I wouldn't dare say October.
Who wipes their butt on a burger?
So, I found this website, mylife.com.
Oh, you found them there?
Well, I don't know. Because Dave Jackson is such a popular name, there's like hundreds of Dave Jacksons. So I've narrowed it down to, you know, I know his age, and I know kind of like he's in the Chicagoland area. So now I've got it down to like a couple hundred. And I almost started to go a little bit further to see if it was him or not. And it wants like $30 for a 3-month trial. Or a 3-month period of using the services. And I didn't want to drop $30 because I'm afraid. I mean, Dave's cool. I would really love to find him, and he's definitely worth $30, but I'm afraid of giving this place, this site, $30 of my money.
Because it could not be him after all.
Yeah. So I just kind of canceled out of it. But now, every day, I get an email saying, Dave Jackson has been found. Dave Jackson has been found. Connected with Dave Jackson at last? And I keep deleting these things. Every day, a new Dave Jackson is being found, and I don't know if it's our Dave. And I don't know how to turn off the alert.
David! David! The window! David, she broke the window!
Get away from there! Stay out of the car!
I'm coming in! I can't stand it out here!
Now stay out of the car! I warn you, I've got a gun!
We are trying to find a place to hide Tisha. You know, something challenging enough, but yet not so off the beaten path that no one will ever visit her. Because our goal is to actually get her to Chicken, Alaska.
Hi, Baba.
Hi.
Hello, little person.
This is Kat. She was born 4 hours after me.
Hello.
Hello, Kat. How are you?
Good.
Cat, like the animal.
Yes, I knew. Presley, who was found dead in the bathroom after going to the toilet, was thought to have died from cardiac arrhythmia, possibly brought on by drug dependency, obesity, and a weak heart.
He wasn't obese.
Towards the end he was.
Oh.
Yeah, this picture of him here, this was not 1977. That's the 50s Elvis.
Oh.
The Vegas Elvis that you're listening to here was the constipated Elvis. I am in the process of setting up my new restaurant, which is opening this weekend in Chicago. You can find me at 310A, as in A Good Food, South Canal Street in Chicago.
Police say someone out there is missing a part of their body. You use them every day, whether to ride a bike or perhaps to balance yourself in the water like this girl. But a local police department says someone out there is missing a crucial part of their body. Jacksonville Beach police say someone found a prosthetic leg washed up on shore right here near 10th Avenue North.
You know, that song is about a certain someone named Lily.
Lucky Lily.
But I have a poem about her.
Oh, no.
And this is it. It's called Loudmouth Lily.
Okay.
All right.
Got such a loud mouth, driving me insane. I'm really cranky. Thank you, that's it.
What the?
Okay, get out of here, Philip.
For many people, hearing the word Godfather brings up images of Italian mob bosses, calling in hits on rival mob families or snitches within their own ranks. But there's actually more to being Il Patrino than granting favors and running a criminal organization. The reality is that taking on the role of a godfather to a child is a very big honor that comes with important responsibilities. Unfortunately, many men today have no clue what exactly they're supposed to do as a godfather.
That's your problem.
That's precisely why I looked this up. To help remedy that, we have developed a short guide to being a great godfather. Read it, or you'll be sleeping with the fishes.
What the heck?
It's a line from the movie. Luca Brasi sleeps with the fishes.
Next.
I don't do a very good Marlon Brando, or do I? I think I need to stuff my cheek with
some
cream.
Sound like Simon Bar Sinister.
From Underdog?
Yeah.
Oh, get that, Underdog!
I got the worst damn headache after I ate here. I felt like I just... Oh, hold on a second. I felt like I have sometimes after eating... Shitty.
Wait a minute. Second. You can't say that.
I thought this is the internet. I could say anything.
There, that's what we need. What was that again?
Do I read it over again?
No, let's keep going.
Okay. Chinese, like crummy Chinese food. The dead MSG giveaway. Pulsing temples. My lamb / chickpea / rice thing didn't taste like... shitty Chinese food. But I felt like shit soon after. I think your beeps are a little off.
We would edit it in later.
I like that. That should be a Smorg Show staple.
The sensor bleed coming in too late.
Yeah.
We're a low budget operation here.
Now catch some news balls.
Orange County woman was sentenced to a year in jail for sending hundreds of threatening text messages to herself.
Oh, why, oh, why did you spit on me? If you knew better, you'd wipe it up with a towel.
Yeah, hi, this is Conrad Blackwell calling on behalf of Baba's Village Restaurant. Look, we've heard the feedback you've given our restaurant on your show, and we would really appreciate it if you could cease the ill publicity and bad reviews. Otherwise, I'm afraid the next step is that we will be contacting our attorney. Thanks.
This man claims that I stole the name of Baba's Village, and that I'm wrecking his restaurant's profitability and customer base. Because of this, these poor ratings, these reviews that we read on the show a few weeks ago.
That's absurd.
Well, I have a few things to say to Mr. Conrad Blackbeard.
Uh-oh.
Or Blackburn Blacksmith, I don't know.
I think it's Blackwell, but go on.
Those are my reviews.
Yeah.
I am the one who's supposed to be taking the hit, and I am the one who has been trying to make things improved in my restaurant to counter the negative criticism. So I am a very honest businessman, Mr. Blackburn.
Calm down, Bob. I've never heard you this upset.
The gall that this man has to think that my restaurant reviews are hurting his business is just a bunch of poppycock.
Poppycock?
Yeah. What?
Yes, that's right. Poppycock. I learned that in my my English language class.
No one says poppycock.
And now, the irony of that is that Baba serves poppycock in his restaurant.
It's a big seller.
I remember how stressed you were when you woke up that morning.
Oh, my gosh.
And
I think that really kicked off a whole series of just frantic scrambling here. After Pete was here doing the restaurant reviews, reading Baba's reviews, mm-hmm. And we're just going on and on, talking about all these bad reviews. I guess there was another Baba's Village somewhere down in town that thought we were slamming their restaurant. But there's actually
the show.
Yeah. On the slow. And the attorney calls us and tells us to stop, you know, you slamming the restaurant. And then Baba took offense. It's like, hey, those are my reviews. I'm allowed to talk about this. And I don't know.
Somehow it got cleared up. I don't remember what happened, but it's behind us.
He changed the name of his restaurant after all.
Oh, right. A Taste of Baba.
A Taste of Baba.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. He got a better marketing tactic.
That's right.
Yeah. A Taste of Baba. That's better marketing. Yeah.
Let me try to think of some of the other standout moments there.
For the record, I love how I just have this chronic cold for the entire first seven months of our show.
Yeah. You were stuffed up quite a bit. As preteens usually are, right?
I don't know.
You certainly were. I'm trying to think one of the other standout moments. This is obviously all pre-Dave. You know, you heard we were trying to find you.
Right.
I remember when we were on the hunt for you.
The hunt for Dave Jackson.
Yeah, it was like a...
The movie.
Yeah.
I do remember getting those alerts every day saying, Dave Jackson has been found. I had this my heart just, you know, started beating faster.
So I sort of picked up on it unconsciously, and then I wrote you.
That's right.
Yeah, and
out of the blue, you heard from me, and I didn't know you were looking for me.
It was a vibe.
And then we made that movie trailer, Dave and Chris reunited again, and then we had a little bromance going on.
Reunited and it feels so good.
Well, we do find you in the next segment, so we'll get to that. But let's see. What else, Allie? Did you see anything?
Like a Seinfeld episode. All of these underlying conflicts. You know.
Yeah. Yeah, we were just kind of playing around and just reading news articles and not really doing anything really high tech. Although we did start doing the radio plays. There were a couple in there. It started out actually being. Your birthday party.
That's right.
We got, you know, like those murder mystery kits, the murder mystery parties. Okay. She had something, murder in the mansion.
Mm-hmm.
And I took the script from the game for the kids to play, and we turned it into a radio play.
And for my birthday party, I had to tell all of my guests, okay, here's the character. You're going to be the limo driver. You're going to be the butler, you know, all this stuff. And then people would have to arrive to the party in costume, and then... We kind of just played out this whole thing, found out who murdered me, I think it was, and then turned it into a radio play, and then, yeah, you're right, that's what started all of our...
So does the game give you the whole script, or do you improvise some of this?
Oh, I see what you mean.
Oh, wait, was it a script?
Does it
I think it was a script that we read from. We found it online somewhere, didn't we? It was like birthday party ideas. I always had like a different theme.
So this is
a thing
people do.
Well, you have at least back then.
Murder mystery.
I don't know.
Party.
Never went to. Did you ever go to another party like that?
Like that? No.
No.
I went to a lot of Chuck E. Cheese parties in my day.
Yeah, we took it up a notch over here at the at our household. But wow, I don't know who that was. Let's see, you did a show with Daryl Woltman. You remember him from WDGC, our high school days. His daughter was born 4 hours apart from Allie, so that was kind of a neat find. So the two of them did a show together.
That's a funny story that when you guys got reunited and you're talking about, you know, oh, what have you been doing the last, you know, like over the years, and you found out you guys both had a daughter born on the same day, born within 4 hours.
Yeah. Yeah. That was kind of neat. So I guess now we're in, we're segment two. And I think we're going to launch something here now. That music could only mean one thing.
And that would be?
Hello!
Baba!
Hello, hold on a second!
Oh!
Elsie, calm down!
It looks like you have an agitated elephant on your hands there, Baba.
Oh, wow, he got past customs.
Oh, hello, everybody. Look at this place. What the hell is this place?
It's called America, Baba.
This is a hellhole.
We thought you might be able to get some, you know, recipe ideas here in the barn.
This is amazing here. What have you done to the place? This isn't the studio anymore, is it? Hey, Ali, how are you? You got bigger.
So did you, Baba.
Oh, yes, I got bigger in the belly. Oh, Jerry Malauskas, what the hell happened to you?
That's a long story, Baba. Oh,
I have not seen you in years since you were out at the restaurant.
Good times at the restaurant, Baba, good times.
And Dave, you are always looking the same.
Oh, it's great to see you, Baba.
Hey, Baba, good to see you too. So, I'm an old man now. Can I sit down, Allie? Can I sit over here? Is this my mic? I can take this mic. Right?
That's a little bit more portable. That's the guest mic.
Okay.
There you go.
I'm looking for my show notes. Where are my show notes?
I thought we printed them out for you.
I've been writing on the plane my notes.
Oh, those.
So, you know, I could not have picked a better time to vacate my country, to come back over here to the United States. Have you not heard the news?
The news.
Oh, my goodness. The news. I was almost killed.
By an elephant?
No, not quite. But by dropping objects out of the sky. Well, let me start by explaining the backstory. So about 3 weeks ago, the Times of India had first reported that some strange events had started to unfold in the Fasipur Badli village of Gugaram. You know the place.
Of course.
Just on the road from you, right?
Well, it's in South Delhi.
Oh, okay.
So according to a report by the news outlet, it all started when this farmer by the name of Rajbir Yadav.
Oh, Raj, yeah.
Good old Raj.
Yes, Raj, we like to call him that. He had gone out to his field to conduct his morning ritual, and he saw something really unexpected. He witnessed this big piece of rock coming straight from the sky and hitting the earth with a very loud noise. He witnessed, he wasn't sure what it was.
Meteor?
Well, that was actually, you are jumping ahead. He called other people from the village to see what they thought. So the villagers quickly gathered at the farmer's place. The word spread very quickly. From the farm to the barns to the alleys, within no time, the entire village was talking about it. People poured into the wheat farm for a look. Now, a little bit of Indian culture.
Okay.
The thought is, if something falls from the sky, it must be God sent. So, was this some form of a rare mineral or some sort of a geological treasure? Some villagers believed this. And so they started to sneak pieces of this find into their clothing. And they brought it back to their house. And they put it in the refrigerator.
Refrigerator?
For safekeeping, yes. And then they went back to their normal business. But some of the more informed ones among the villagers took a guess. And this is what they said. Who said, who thought it was a meteor? Well, that was you, Allie, right?
That sounds like a meteor to me.
Well, the stone had white texture. It was ice cold with a transparent surface. So they called the meteorological department, and they came out to take a look. And after thorough investigation,
oh, I think I know this.
Unlike what everybody was expecting, they revealed that it was no meteor. It was not a celestial wonder, as seen in the science fiction movies. It was blue ice.
Yeah, that's what I
thought. Oh, you know what that is.
Oh, yes. Very well. Very well.
It is frozen toilet waste leaking from the plains. More precisely, it is a frozen mix of human excrement and liquid disinfectants.
And they give it such a nice name, like blue ice.
Blue ice, yes. Well, human excrement can be dangerous if dropped from substantial heights.
I can only imagine the smell after it thaws.
Oh, well. Oh, my music is... What happened to my music? Thank you very much. So, many people were very disappointed upon this news, and now they're back at their homes cleaning out their refrigerators. So, back to present day. I was out minding my own business this past week when one of those big falling pieces fell from the sky within 3 meters of yours truly. And this is when I decided to leave town and come to see all of you fine people.
Where is it falling from?
Airplanes flying overhead.
Oh.
So, I'm not going back there.
They need to close up their back door.
You know, they have planes here, too, that, you know, might drop things.
That is very true. Has this ever happened to any of you? I have not seen this.
You guys had an incident?
No.
Well, it's been going on for 3 weeks in Delhi, so I don't know what's going on over there. And who's flying overhead? Speaking of poop.
Maybe India's under attack.
I'd like to talk a little bit about poop real quick. So, dropping your phone down your toilet can be annoying enough, but finding yourself trapped inside the tank beneath, as happened to one Punjab man, takes things to a whole new level.
Inside the tank?
Yes, this is Baba News, by the way. This actually happened to a Punjab man. After a friend dropped a cell phone into a public toilet in the Pathakot district of Punjab, Raj Kumar volunteered to retrieve it, which was a brave deed.
Yeah, I would say so.
What the heck is going on with the music?
A random gong put in there. It's the gong show.
The 20-year-old, who is slim enough to climb through the toilet seat and into the tank below, quickly found himself standing up to his thighs in feces. Kumar wasn't aware at that stage that the tank is usually emptied only once a year. Fire services later confirmed that it had been pretty full down there. And while slim enough to get in... Oh, I already said that. Who typed this up here? It's saying the same thing twice.
Thought you did on the airplane.
Way to listen, Ellie.
Was it a black or a blue ice dropping airplane, by the way?
He realized soon enough that he was thin enough to climb down, but not out again.
Huh.
It was disgusting as hell, he said. The worst thing I've ever experienced. Animals were down there too. I will never enter a toilet again.
Sounds like they need smaller toilets over there. Like we do.
Now my body hurts and I will go home and get some rest, he told the Punjab news outlet. After spending 1 hour in the tank without being able to get out, his friends called the fire brigade, who told the news outlet that the rescue had been a first for them.
No doubt.
Soon, a team of 4 men armed with a chainsaw managed to smash open the plastic toilet and pulled Kumar out into the fresh and poop-free air.
That's like getting stuck in a porta potty over here. I
think that's kind of what it's like. It sounds more like an outhouse than it does an actual...
Yeah, that's what it sounds like.
And you know, every porta potty, I've yet to go to a porta potty where someone did not get sick. Doesn't it always look like the last person that used it just had bad afternoon?
Yeah, but when you walk into a
bad afternoon.
When you walk into a porta potty, the smell alone would make you sick.
Oh, I know. I would just call a plumber at that point.
Kumar was taken to the hospital where he was treated for minor injuries and also received antibiotic treatment.
For the trauma, too.
He also presumably took a shower.
One would hope.
For those of you who are wondering about the phone, it did not share the same happy fate as Kumar. It did not make it out of the tank.
Just leave it in some rice.
Oh, no.
That's what right. About the phone?
Did you learn that trick on YouTube?
Oh, yeah.
But what happened to the poor phone?
Oh, no. Well, thank you very much, so much for that. You came all the way, 6,000, 7,000 miles to tell us that. Yes. I am going to go take care of some things, and I will meet you at the after party. Great to see you guys.
Hey, Baba.
Later, Baba.
As always.
There will be cookies at the after party.
The after party. Okay, well, that was interesting as always. I think we can kill that. Kill the band. Okay.
Where'd the elephant go?
Did somebody tell him that's not a farm animal?
Sounded like Louis Armstrong.
Well, not a...
Maybe farms over in India, they do have elephants.
That's what I was saying. In America, it may not be a farm animal, but you never know over there.
Oh, my
there's
goodness.
There's a difference in cultures there.
That is a very angry elephant.
You would be, too, if you were brought all these miles. Okay, well, hey, let's go into segment two, collage number two, episodes 26 through 50. This is dated August 14th, 2010, all the way to April 11th, 2011. And this lasts about, this is a 17-minute segment, so sit back and enjoy. Go get a coffee, will you?
You don't want to miss this.
No. This is the Smorg Show podcast. We're celebrating 100 episodes with Allie, Dave, and Jerry.
Hey, it's time for news balls.
First news story is it's about a toad-licking chef who was busted on YouTube. This is out of Davenport, Iowa. Story about a seemingly bored chef by the name of Christopher Turla. Started making out with a couple of toads and even stuffed them in his mouth while unknowing diners were enjoying their meal at the Japanese restaurant where he worked.
Okay.
Where do I get these stories?
Where is that Peet McCain?
He had some difficulties with his microphone.
He was supposed to be here. I wanted to give him a piece of my mind. He was the one who started all of this problem. Last month, with those reviews. Without him, I would not be facing the trouble that I have over these last months.
Don't get excited. Think clearly. How am I going to kill her? Oh, I wish it were over. I could go back then. Go back to David. If I can go through it, I can go back in her place. I'll do anything to be happy again. I'll learn to smile again. Anything to smile. She must die. How? Yes, stairwell. She gets dizzy when she looks down into the stairwell. Yes, it could be so easy. Good. In a day or two, that police officer will come back to the house. He'll find her and they'll think it's me. The stairwell. Three floors from the attic here. Three floors straight down. So easy when you think clearly. The stairwell, of course.
I got back from an adventure.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Tell me about your adventure.
Like, it's a, kind of a Pottery Barn and tea room place. So we went there today, and we had the best strawberry lemonade there. And we had a veggie dip, and we had a brownie with vanilla ice cream on top.
That must have cost you a fortune.
Nope, $18.72.
Where'd you get that kind of money?
Well, we both chipped in, and I left the waitress a tip.
Nice.
And she must have really liked us, because then when we asked her if she got her tip, because we saw her outside later on, she's like, yes, and you didn't have to give me a tip. That was so nice. You guys are so sweet.
It was just the two of you?
Yeah. She called us cute.
Aw, you guys gave her a tip.
Yeah.
How'd you figure it out?
I just left her $1.30.
$1.30 on a $17 tab?
$18.72.
Man, that's like 8% or something.
Whatever. We're little kids. And she had said to us, if you guys don't have enough money, then believe me, I will help you out.
Hey everyone, it's me, Philip. I am taking voice lessons. So, and I decided to sing a song that I was learning in my voice lessons. It is called The Water is Wide. You're gonna like this. Thanks.
The water is wide. I gaze across a distance, and neither am I chasing, but it's too bad.
Big news. A couple weeks ago, I told you we had to test our basement for radon, radioactive gas, and got the report back from the lab, and we have been tested positive.
Does that mean we have it?
We have gas. Radioactive gas, that
okay.
is.
It's time to play Family Feud.
Anthony, name something that you wear, even if it has a hole in it.
How about my stockings?
Your stockings, okay. If stockings is up there, you steal the points and the game. Stockings. Yes!
Yes!
Team 1
yes,
has won!
Mystical Melinda.
She is in the studio with us.
Welcome, Mystical. Do you like to go by Mystical?
Mystical is fine.
We haven't seen you in over 25 years.
I know, it's been a long time, and I haven't changed at all, right?
No, you haven't. Neither have I, have I?
No, you've grown up a little bit.
Yeah, I was
and
a teenager.
And you've got a little one, too. I mean, I have never met Allison.
Yeah, this isn't Dave.
She's quite a lovely young lady.
I would hope I'm not.
You don't know what happened to Dave.
You are not Dave. You do not look like Dave at all. I remember Dave.
Good. That's not my intention.
Radon gas is very, it's a natural substance. It's from the breakdown of the natural elements in the soil and the bedrock, and it comes through your foundation in your basement, gets in through the cracks, or sometimes it can even get in the water supply, and it's very dangerous. It's the number two cause of lung cancer number two cause of lung cancer in general, number one cause of lung cancer in non-smokers, which would be us. So we did this test. We came out at a six level, which I think the maximum is 4. And at that point, they tell you to retake the test. Well, we realized we had the windows open during that test, so we thought...
Which gets rid of some of it, so...
Yeah, it creates a vacuum effect, and it sucks the gas out of your house. So they said you should probably do the test again, keep your windows closed for the full 4-day duration, and see what you get. Well, got the results back on Friday. We're at a 12.7.
Yeah, and... That's pretty bad considering that anything above 4 is dangerous.
It's this room. We, last weekend we moved up here because of the radon trouble, which, by the way, we have taken care of. We had the radon mitigator out to the house on Friday, and he has repaired the repaired the basement, installed the whole system to suck the radon out of the house. So we can move back down downstairs at any time now. But ever since we've been up here, I've been breathing in the guinea pig.
You're not breathing in the guinea pig. You're breathing in her bedding. You better get that checked out.
I don't like the way she's acting with the customers. I'm a customer. Well, I'm coming here to buy something.
Okay, I understand that, but that's not a police matter, sir.
And then...
Customer service is not a reason to call 911. 911 is if you're dying. Do you understand that?
Okay?
Don't call 911 because you're unhappy with somebody's customer service. I understand that you don't think she should be rude to you, but you can't call 911 for that.
Peggy and her boyfriend Tommy were driving down a lonely stretch of highway at dusk when a thunderstorm came crashing down on them. Tommy slowed the car and they crept their way past a formidable abandoned house. Plastered all over the fences and trees were no trespassing signs.
Happy birthday.
Why don't you sing along, Allie?
I don't know the words.
They're not that hard to figure out.
No, but this is way better than our birthday song in the United States.
I don't think you can get sued over for playing this.
This is bringing back so many memories.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
Thank you so very, very much.
The name turkey stems from the word tuka, which means peacock in India. And have you ever wondered what Turkey, the country in the Middle East, and the American bird have in common? a case of mistaken identity. Jeez, those are wild turkeys. Sounds like dogs. A case of mistaken identity resulted in the American turkey being named after the country. When the Spanish first found the bird in the Americas more than 400 years ago, they brought it back to Europe. The English mistakenly thought it was a bird they called turkey, so they gave it the same name. This other bird was actually from Africa, but came to England by way of the turkey. Lots of shipping went through Turkey at the time. The name stuck, even though they realized the birds weren't the same.
Oh, the wonderful things Mr. Brown can do. Moo, moo, buzz, buzz, pop, pop, pop. Eek, eek, hoo, hoo, clap, clap, clap. Dibble, dibble, dot, dot, cock-a-doodle-doo. Grum.
Oh, no, no, Spirit, no, no, no. Hear me. I'm not the man I was. Why show me this if I'm past all hope? Tell me that I can change these dreadful shadows you've shown me by an altered life. I'll honor Christmas in my heart. I'll try to keep it all the year. I'll live in the past, the present, and the future. And I'll not shut out the lessons that they teach. Tell me, Spirit. Oh, go on, tell me. Tell me that I can sponge away the writing on that stone, Spirit. I beg you, Spirit. I beg you.
Well, I think I'll let everybody go to their cabinets and get out their cookies, and I'll wait while you get those. 'Twas the night before Christmas when all through the house, not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse. I like mice. I think they're cute.
I do, too.
$16 billion in our cash call. Dave doesn't pick up the phone unless he recognizes the phone number. And since we're calling him from the Smorg Show hotline, he's probably not familiar with the number.
Yeah.
Dave has no answering machine. And I think he said he uses dial-up, which I didn't think any internet provider still offered that.
Hello.
Dave Jackson, you're on the air.
I'm on the air? Really?
Hey, my old friend, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you.
So good to hear from you.
Hey, some behind-the-scenes kind of stuff for those listening at home. I actually knew we were going to be on the air. Chris asked me if I wanted to go. Do you say on the air for the internet?
What do we say, Allie? By the way, I've got Allie here with me.
Hi.
Hi, Allie. Hi.
Sorry, she kind of replaced you over the years.
That's okay. You look more like Chris than I do.
Thanks.
She's got some pretty big shoes to fill.
You know, when you said, do you want to go on, and I'll call you back, I started, like, shadow boxing.
Seriously?
Yeah, like, you know, getting ready to step in the ring or something.
Please do not offend the vegetarian owner by asking for meat. Huh? I think we all understand this point now. I move on to number two. Number two.
You are so easily amused, Baba.
Number two. If it is not wet or messy, it is okay to eat with your hand.
Well, it doesn't sound right after you say
number two.
Yeah,
after you say number two. Is the number two wet and messy? Or?
Yes, it is. Very much so.
January day. Sun's shining. Snow's melting. Mosquitoes are a little bit rough, but it's all right. Hey, thanks for the great cash. This is a great day. And hello, everybody. And until next time, goodbye.
Mosquitoes?
In January? In Illinois?
Okay.
Okay.
Hey, hey, everybody! The object of the game is to get a life better than the one you have presently. What the audience needs to play is a worthless life that leaks oil and makes strange sounds when you go around the corner that you want to trade in for a new 2011 life that gets good mileage, enables you to be that popular socialite at school functions, that person that everybody gathers around at parties, or helps you get that vice presidential job that you know you deserve. You must demonstrate that you are deserving of a new life by being polite, receptive, and humble. All lives go away on the show today come with air conditioning, a view of the lake, a 5-year or 50,000-mile warranty on all movable parts, and a limited 30-day warranty that allows you to return to your life if all claims made today about your new life turns out to be absolute rubbish. Live, take a fake at midnight tonight, so say goodbye to all your friends now before it's too late.
A man, a filthy man, smelling from head to toe, came in asking for water.
Okay.
And I have told my employees that the policy is never, ever to give out a free handout, even if it is only water.
Okay.
Because it just encourages the behavior.
Right.
So we said no water to you when he came up to the counter. It was lunchtime. He went up to the takeout counter and asked for water. When my employee told him no and to please leave, he screamed at us many, many obscenities that I could not possibly share here.
Please don't.
With this audience, because this is a family show.
That's right.
Yeah. So,
okay.
He left the restaurant against his will. And about 15, 20 minutes later, he came back into the restaurant. This time, he was armed with a container of his own filthy urine.
Oh.
That's right.
I didn't see that on the news.
And he threw it over the counter at one of my employees. Fortunately, it did not hit her, but it exploded all over the floor. And it splashed all over my beautiful counter.
Ew.
Oh.
And it smelled awful.
I can imagine.
So we called the police.
Yeah?
And the man left again. But he said he would be back. And I remember the Terminator when he said, I'll be back. What that means.
That's right. Watch
so
out.
He came back. This time he was armed with a container, not of urine, but of gasoline. And he put it on the counter.
Oh my.
And he took out a match.
Oh no.
And he tried to strike the match.
Oh,
when all of a sudden, down from the heavens, came a very, very honorable man who tackled the stinky, filthy urine man to the floor.
Good.
And his family live in a 100-room, 4-story house set amidst the hills of Baktuang Village in Mazoram, where the wives sleep in giant communal dormitories.
You have an incoming call from Peet McCain.
What does
Studio
he want?
C.
What do you... Ilu, what do you want?
Did I miss a call?
I don't know, I did not call you. Get off of my phone!
I want to do It's a Wonderful Life for this holiday season. I know we just finally got to spring, but I'm already thinking ahead for the holidays. So we'll do a radio play party, and we'd have to figure out who's Jerry. I wanted Jerry to play the Jimmy Stewart part.
I can see that.
Mr. Potter.
There you go. I think you could pull it off. I think you want to do
Jimmy
Potter.
You want Jimmy Stewart for 1A, hours on end.
1A.
I guess you could try.
Happy New Year in jail.
I just want to say the 1A part.
1A.
That's all I want to do.
It's like, no one knows that line.
No one knows what it's the least quoted line of the whole movie.
Yeah. So you missed a good show last time. It was fun having my old radio partner, Dave Jackson, down here with me.
Mm-hmm.
We had a lot of fun doing that one. So we'll definitely have him back and maybe try to get all three of us together.
Sounds like your voiceover class was fun too, Sam.
Yeah, the voiceover class went really well. In fact, right now I've got an email out to the voice company, Voices for All, to inquire about their full class, which is, it comes around, I think, every 2 or 3 months in Chicago. And I'm going to do the full class, which it's a couple grand to get through it, but apparently they make you your demo tape and then you can get put out there for hopefully other people to find and give you jobs. So, hey, I could be your next Walmart shopper announcer. Hey, clean up at aisle 6. Well, we're back.
Good memories just, there.
Yes, that's true. I was say not just to clean up an aisle 6, but I think the one of the sheep over there, there's going to be a cleanup.
Oh yeah, I know.
Later.
I'm starting to smell
clean up
some
on stable 6.
Yeah,
stable 6. Yeah, that's it.
Wow, where do we start there? Let's
it's
see.
Weird to get back into present moment after kind of traveling back in time a bit here.
Yeah, some of that stuff I hadn't heard in many years. Mystical Melinda jumped out, something that happened back.
Yeah. That was, I haven't heard that bit since 30, it's been 30 years.
Yeah.
Was that the only time we had her on?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was the only time. Certainly the radon gas thing was kind of a scare for a while. We had to move everything upstairs. Fortunately, back then, we didn't have nearly the amount of stuff we do now.
Oh, can you imagine trying to move our studio now?
Oh, no way. No.
So what do they do to irradoniate you?
Well, they installed, I don't even know what you call it, but there's like a thing over there that just sucks it out. There's like this, I don't know, even know what it is. You know what it is? It looks like almost like a thermometer, the liquid that...
Well,
it's some sort of a meter.
It doesn't matter as long as it works. That's the main thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't care how strange it looks. As long as does its job.
Hopefully the thing still works. I mean, it looks nice on the wall. I just hope it's doing something.
Well, I
should probably do another test.
Yeah, I didn't realize. Yeah, retest it.
I didn't realize we got all the way up to a 12.7. That's like terrible.
It's a mitigator.
I mean, did you do a retest? Do you know that it's better? Or did the guy just charge you and then leave?
Yeah, but the windows were open. I'm kidding.
No, he's talking since that we got the thing installed. No, we haven't tested. We just took his word.
We could be being poisoned right now. You're just.
I've been down here a lot. A lot of hours since then. Well, we'll see.
That explains a lot.
Maybe it'll be something we do in 2019, Allie.
Yeah. Well, Dave had his debut, too. That's what we heard in that last
Yeah, that was
segment.
A big moment. That was great finding you and having you out.
The unveiling.
Yeah, that was a major new chapter of my life that opened up.
Yeah.
Meeting all of you. And
it brought a dimension to this show.
Reconnecting, that was a major thing for me.
I snuck in there a few times myself.
Yeah, you came out to the restaurant, Bob's restaurant.
Mm-hmm. And you know what's funny? That whole conversation about It's a Wonderful Life is the roles were flipped. So you role of George Bailey, Mr. Potter, you guys ended up actually, Jerry, you did Mr. Potter. And then
my dad
did George Bailey. So.
That's right.
Yeah, when we actually did the real auditions, it just made more sense, I think.
Because you're just naturally more crotchety? Is that what, is that what you're saying about Jerry?
I did a good crotchety old man.
Well, maybe. I get it from my dad. What can I say?
Yeah. And then Dave and I went to voiceover class together. That was something that happened during that time.
Yeah, that was harsh.
I forgot about that.
I took all those notes, and then they told me I'd never work in this business. It was just brutal.
Yeah.
When a community college tells you you don't have the chops.
Yeah.
That's sad.
That's hard.
Crushing your dreams.
It crushed me.
Huh. All right. Well, I hear something off in the distance, guys.
Yeah, what is that?
Yeah, I hear it too.
It sounds like a very sick tractor.
That tractor does not sound good at all.
Oh,
no.
Don't step there.
Oh, my goodness.
Something's scraping? What is that?
Wheezing and a sneezing.
Oh, my goodness.
Hey, guys.
Oh, it's Philip.
Philip.
Hey, Philip.
Philip Donald.
Oh, Allie, Chris, Dave, Jerry, I haven't seen you guys in years.
I know. It's been, I guess, at least 6 or 7 years since you've been here, and we talked to you earlier in the year from, I don't know if we were to talk about it. You may not want to.
Well, you know, I'm in a state of just trying to move on, reboot my life, get myself back together, sculpt the new me. But it's great being here in the flesh once again.
Now, you are out now. You don't have to go back. You are completely free. You are a free citizen.
I am a free man.
Does everybody know the story? I guess we should set this up for the audience who don't know. Philip Donald is our resident songwriter.
Musical genius.
Yeah.
Who had a little bad luck.
A little bad luck. Do you want to talk a little bit about what happened?
Well, I feel like a lot of the story was kind of relayed in earlier in the year when we were on the phone together. But really, I think the one reason I'm really excited to be here is because I have a new song to share with you guys, and I feel like the song itself really explains all that. You know, this whole year has been just a reflective state of mind for me. I've, you know, kind of just had a lot of time to think about who am I, and I talk about my experience in this song. It really, you guys got to hear this. I don't want to give it all away.
Can't wait.
I think we should at least say that Philip did have some trouble on a playground.
Baltimore.
Why were you out in Baltimore again?
Do you like crab cakes?
Oh, I love crab cakes, but you know, I was just trying to put some more good out into this world and share some candies and sweets. And, you know, the whole thing just snowballed into this misunderstanding. And it's really violating to just feel like you're so misunderstood by people.
You know, ironically, this is exactly how Philip met Allie when we first started this show.
Mm.
Allie, you remember that?
Yeah, I do. And I think it was sandwiches then.
Mm. On your school playground. Allie comes home from school one day and says, hey, I met this, I don't know how old he was at the time, 29 or so, man on the playground, and I'd like to bring him home to you, Dad.
You know, I feel like this story gets,
a, little more
gets a little bit more twisted over the years.
Yeah, I've had time to to process exactly what happened. But no, anyway, Philip had a repeat incident, and it's been a misunderstanding, apparently. And so how long has it been? You were in prison for how long?
It was about 6 months that I was locked away and forced to just sit in my thoughts. But I gotta tell you guys, great things have come from that, because once I was out, I feel like that was what gave me the big break I've been dreaming of. I met these great people from a work release program, and we just got this band together and just began writing. We all came from such a wounded place and ready to move on with our lives, and so it's great. We recorded the song together. We're planning to go on tour next summer, and you know, it's been really great. Things are good.
Yeah, I was wondering who you brought with you, and I see that they're setting up their equipment now, so I guess you're going to get ready to play a song live for us, right?
Yep, that's the crew over there, and we're just really excited. I can't remember the last time I was actually here in person playing for you guys.
That's great.
Well, I can't wait to hear it.
Is this record going to have a release, or are you going to be able to get it to the wider public?
Yeah, you guys are the first to hear this, but we're planning on the release happening early in the new year, 2019, so keep your eyes peeled for it.
Right, and your album's coming out on Candy Records?
Yeah, I got a really sweet deal.
Mm-hmm. That's great.
Well, 2019 will be the year of Philip Donald.
Can't wait. All right. Well, thanks, Philip. It's great to see you, and we will talk to you soon.
All right, I got to get set up, and I'll see you guys soon.
Okay, give us a signal when you're ready. That was good to see him. So we're just minutes away here from hearing the brand new song. I can't wait.
I am so ready for this.
I'm stoked.
I still remember when he came down here and debuted his first album, Such a Good Ugly Thing.
Mm-hmm.
He had a great interview with him. Dave had asked the challenging questions as usual.
I tried.
He really likes to get to know all the guests.
That's important.
That song just has a way of getting under your skin.
Moving you, touching you in places you've never been touched.
It touched me.
Speaking of being touched, he was working on a children's album, and it was going to be called, the working title was For the Kitties.
I think that was the last we heard of him before everything went downhill.
Yeah, he spiraled.
He took a new direction, I think. I'm excited for this the debut of his new song.
Yeah. I think we're getting the signal that it's time to go. So hopefully we got the feed going here. So I understand the song is called Break Loose. And here we go. Smork Show Podcast, brand new, Philip Donald. Take it away, Philip.
Guy, you think I am sophisticated all around? I even roast yams, so don't you say I don't have class. I'm not the roaming creep that they say I am. Don't make your accusations just because I drive a van. They took my every pound of dignity. How many times do I have to say it's not me that you should be taking away? I've got three bags of candy still left inside. But officers are clear about taking bribes. Why is it a crime if I decide to share my smile with you? Here I wallow in my thoughts, just hoping I will soon break loose. I've got to break loose. I never even got the chance to explain. Now there's local news alerts and orders of restraint. How will I ever tell my mom? I'm sleeping on a bed with no lumbar support. Breakfast, lunch, and dinner here are really a bore. Tallies on the wall and lyrics to this song, hoping that I won't be here for long. Why is it a crime if I decide to share my smile with you? Here I wallow in my thoughts, just hoping I will soon break loose. Well, I broke loose, so here I am, the real me. Oh yeah.
Wow.
All right.
Yeah! That's amazing!
Trying to keep it together.
that was brilliant.
Wow, you really hear his pain in there.
I do.
Beautiful song.
Yeah.
Love it.
Yeah. I see. There's actually a part in the song, I think the bridge, where it sounds a little bit like a band that I know that you like, Chris, called Echosmith. I think they have a little Echosmith flavor in there.
Really?
You can hear some influence coming through
in
there?
Wow. Maybe it's me, but I'm just hearing it. Yeah.
Well, I could see this band going pretty far. I think he said they're touring next year, so.
Well, good. I don't think they'll be as big as Echosmith, but they'll probably do pretty well.
The Philip Donald Band. I'll see if I can get you some tickets.
Yeah, well, this is a surefire hit. This is going to be a hit.
Yeah, I hear it. I think
there's no doubt.
Tastes are changing, and I think it's moving in that direction.
Yeah, I like the direction.
Yeah.
Nice job, Philip.
Good acoustics in this barn too.
Yeah, good sound in here. All right. Well, we are in segment three now, and I think we've got another montage here, and then we're going to come back after the montage and. Got a couple more things planned. Allie, you've got your band here.
Yeah, we're going to be hearing some more live music.
Live music tonight from Allie and Philip. Thomas. Thomas is the other part of the duet.
Yes.
And I guess he'll be showing up to the barn a little later. And you're going to be doing a couple songs, cover?
We're doing a cover and an original.
An original, yeah. Looking forward to hearing that. Okay, guys, let's go into our third segment. So this is episodes, I'm so lost here, 51 through 75.
Is that right? So let's see. So it says April of 2011 through May of 2012. Yeah. So you can see that instead of it, you know, like the first segment, it was 25 episodes over the course of 7 months. Now it's over the course of a little over a year.
Yeah,
so you can see how the frequency is.
It's dropping off.
Yeah.
Yeah. So here we go. This is the third collage. Sit back and enjoy. We'll be back in a little bit.
Do you, Allie, do you get the warm and fuzzy feelings when you see blinking lights?
I must be missing out on something. I'm sorry.
Only a man can appreciate
that. It's like the woman
that
gets the whole house. And the man gets a little section.
Yeah.
And maybe we like it that way.
Yeah, I think the most common answer for when people say, hey, where's your dad? It's, oh, he's in his man cave.
Right.
Although we're a different kind of man.
Are you?
Okay.
Well, because I went over,
my wife took us out. We had she accepted an invite from her friend who has a husband and got us out on the town. We went to dinner together, and then we went back to their house for some drinks and watch a movie and stuff. And this guy is into cycling, and he showed me his workshop of all his bicycles and all the tires and how he, you know, has to replace them because he does some heavy cycling. And after 6 months, he's got to replace his tires. He's got his whole workshop of that. And I could appreciate it, but I wasn't like, oh, wow. And then he took me over to this metal shop. He's got like this, all this metal making equipment where he's able to make like,
I'm getting that tingly feeling already.
You are? You like this stuff?
A little bit.
Okay, so maybe I'm
not
a different
good
kind
at
of
it,
man.
But I mean, I like going into the hardware store. Is that what you're talking about? That kind of feeling? Being around the power tools?
Right. I don't have that same feeling like, you know, I do around microphones.
Bit. I get that a little bit. But I'm more excited by the equipment.
I don't feel no either question. One.
So maybe I'm the freak.
Yeah.
0 hours at 5 o'clock.
When?
Today. That's when the invasion is supposed to be. Oh, these kids and their imaginations.
And they talked a little more. School girlfriends. Casual woman talk. But Mrs. Morris was thoughtful. She was thinking of other things. Of adults. Of children with imagination. Rose bushes. Dimensions. She thought about how much she had forgotten about being a child. And she wondered about Mink. And all the kids who were at that moment playing invasion.
I'm so glad you called.
It was great talking to you. Give my love to Henry and a kiss for Mink.
I will. And to Bill and the kids.
Thanks. Bye.
Goodbye.
I have something for you guys. Just as a thank you for, you know, promoting my album.
Okay.
It's an autographed picture of the album. And I also have a copy of the CD for you guys.
Wow. That is fantastic. Look at this, Dave.
Well, thank you. This is really... Is there actually a CD in there?
Oh, yes.
Oh, there is.
There is a real CD in there.
Great.
But I want vintage vinyl.
I'm sorry. We ran out of those.
Already? This is your debut. This one was amusing. This is a body odor reference here. They basically say that you can preserve... safeguards your friendship if you use their product. Because you could be... Well, let them talk about it.
Is the sweetheart you married the husband you expected him to be? Has the war created new problems for you in your marriage? To answer these and other personal problems brought in by your friends and neighbors, Arid presents John J. Anthony, founder of the famed Marital Relations Institute, in a brand new program of daily sessions of kindly and helpful advice. Just as Mr. Anthony, by examples in this studio, is helping thousands of men and women solve their personal problems, Arid, too, is helping thousands to solve the important personal problem of underarm perspiration. Arid helps you avoid perspiration damage to clothes and safeguards friendships. Use Arid every day. It helps stop perspiration safely, and at the same time, Arid is a most effective deodorant.
All right, here's an easier question, true or false. If a pack of fireworks has not fully functioned, you should cautiously relight it.
False. Sounds dangerous. I see people relight them all the time.
What do you think, Granny Rose?
Yeah, well, I guess since this is a safety quiz, the answer is probably don't do it.
Right. Any malfunctioning fireworks should be soaked in water and then thrown away. Don't handle them or store them in your pocket.
Oh, that's a terrible place for fireworks.
Have your pants blown up.
Yeah.
That would not be good.
Hot pants. All right, we've got a very special feature here on the Smorg Show podcast. It's a Smorg Show first. We have an exclusive interview with Jordan Martin. Jordan is a singer-songwriter based in the UK and has been featured on the Smorg Show as New Artist of the Week on a number of occasions, actually, over the past 6 months or so. Most recently, back in May, Jordan selected the Smorg Show as an exclusive venue for his debut song, Runaway to Me, the first single released from his EP, Postcards, Coffee, and Lyrics. And let's see, his website, jordanmartin.com, describes him as an energetic, soulful rock singer-songwriter. His music creates a shared nostalgia of personal experiences tied with a common emotional thread that draws listeners together. We now welcome Jordan Martin to our program.
Welcome.
Hi, Jordan.
Hello. Thanks for having me on.
Sure thing.
Thank you for coming on our show. We appreciate it.
But the Colorado Rocky Mountain High, I've seen it rain and fire in the sky. The shadow from the starlight is softer than a lullaby. Rocky Mountain High,
high, Colorado.
Rocky Mountain High.
Right.
I'm Kaminsky, Chopper 880.
All right, Pat, we are just currently getting a look at the World Trade Center. We have something that has happened here at the World Trade Center. We noticed flame and an awful lot of smoke from one of the towers of the World Trade Center. We are just coming up on this scene. This is easily three quarters of the way up. We are, this has, whatever has occurred has just occurred.
September 11th, 2011.
Wow, 10 years ago today.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh. This morning when I awoke and rubbed my eyes, I thought, what a beautiful day. It's the first day of fall and my trees have orange leaves. Thank you, Mother Nature, for this day. Pull out all the jackets, it's a low of 46. It's again that time of year and it's getting chilly. Get the scarves, gloves, apple cider too. Signs of autumn are in.
Chick-fil-A. I could eat there seven times a day, where the people laugh and children play. Oh, I'm in love with Chick-fil-A. Suddenly, I need waffle fries in front of me, with some nuggets and a large sweet tea. Oh, Chick-fil-A, you set me free. Kids, get in the van so we can go there today. But their stores are closed, oh I know, 'cause it's Sunday.
They had just received a generous bid on the house and they had decided to accept it. When Lisa finished emptying the washing machine, she turned to go back upstairs and saw a young woman floating a foot above the staircase.
This is my house! Don't sell my house!
The woman said.
This is a top to, you know, what we use on stage, but it's very, very special because if you can see,
yeah,
the numbers all go to 11. Look, right across the board.
Oh.
11, oh, 11,
and most of
11,
the amps go up to 10.
Exactly.
Does that mean it's louder? Is it any louder?
Well, it's one louder, isn't it? It's not 10. You see, most blokes, you know, be playing at 10. You're on 10 here, all the way up, all the way up,
yeah,
all the way up. You're on 10 on your guitar. Where can you go from there? Where?
I don't know.
Nowhere, exactly. What we do is if we need that extra push over the cliff, you know what we do?
Put it up to 11.
11, exactly. One louder.
Why don't you just make 10 louder and make 10 be the top number and make that a little louder?
These go to 11.
I feel like a bunch of couple of old men here talking about our medical problems.
Well, Wait, did we finish talking about the pill? What the pill would do?
Would just travel through your colon and you'd have like this little iPhone app. That's right. I didn't finish on my idea. You'd have this iPhone app, you know, iColon or something. And
or my colon.
My colon.
Dot I.
And you can actually just watch it traveling through your system on your iPhone. On the go.
That's exactly.
On the go.
And then
It would transmit the information to your doctor while it's going through, so you don't have to collect the pill.
That's a good idea.
Yeah.
And this is a show, a podcast, unlike any others we've done before. Allie has left the room to make room for a few old men. I have the entire Smorg Show gang with me here. This is pretty scary.
A few old men and me. A very old man.
Introductions here, starting with Mr. Peet McCain. How you doing?
Hello, I'm Peet McCain.
Hello, Peet. Welcome to the studio. Next to the left of me, Dave Jackson.
Hi, good to be back.
Hey, glad to have you back. And last, but not least, stage left. Far left.
Yes.
The only.
Radical left.
Radical left.
To everyone's left.
Jerry Malauskas.
That is fitting that you're there.
Power to the people.
I don't know much about it either way. I only know he's dead.
When did he die?
Last night, I believe.
It's likely to be a very cheap funeral. For upon my life, I don't know anybody to go to it. Suppose we make up a party and volunteer.
I don't mind going if lunch is provided.
Yeah. Come to think of it, I'll bet I was his best friend.
What?
Well, we used to nod to each other when we met in the street.
Bert! I'm alive again! Bert!
You sure you're all right? Hey, your mouth's bleeding.
It is? Hey! My mouth's bleeding! Bert, look! Look at the blood coming out of there, would you? Oh, hey! Where's Zeus's Christmas bell? Bert! I had it right in my pocket! Here it is! Hey, it's in my pocket! What do you know about that? Hey, Merry Christmas, Bert!
Well, Merry Christmas! Get in the car, I'll drive you home!
You will, Bert? Well, do that! And turn the siren wide open, huh? Merry Christmas, Bedford Falls! Hey! Merry Christmas, old building alone! Merry Christmas, Mr. Potter!
And a Happy New Year to you in jail!
Yee-hee!
Daddy, teacher says every time a bell rings, an angel gets his wings.
That's right, Zuzu. That's right. Attaboy, Clarence. Attaboy, Clarence. Happy landings.
Here, I made this. This is my demo tape. I have taken all of the best bits from It's a Wonderful Life that features yours truly, Bubba.
You have a lot of time on your hands.
Do we really have to play this?
I think we should.
It is the best performance in the entire play.
Well, I don't know. I thought Dave did a pretty good job as Nick the bartender and
Bert the cop.
Right.
Who changed accents.
Yes, but I add a special flair to the entire production, and I wish you would play this for me now.
All right, well, we'll play it.
Let's play. Stop this music.
That is obnoxious.
Jeez.
Hey, where were you two going on this here now honeymoon? So you are finally getting out of Bedford Falls, eh? Then what? Hey, George, there's something funny going on over there. Look. Look over there at the bank. It looks like a run. Where do you live, buddy? 323 Sycamore. Okay, buddy. You've seen my wife? Bud, my wife took the kid and ran away 5 years ago. And I ain't never seen you before in my life. See? There you are, Bert. That is him. See? I told you so. I don't know. They just disappeared. None of us would have a roof over our heads if it wasn't for you, George. Hey, hey, everybody, a toast. How about a toast?
These are all on Craigslist, huh?
Yeah. The heading is, just looking for a girl to diaper me. There's a picture here.
Oh, my goodness. Is that is that going to be our picture?
I don't know.
Every week we look for a picture that's, that represents the podcast episode, and it goes on our blog. And I haven't figured out what tonight's is going to be yet.
Well, here's what the guy says. Just looking for a girl to diaper me. If you've always wanted to be in charge and diaper me. That's a sentence. All right. I just want to look the best for you in any style diaper and perhaps turn it into a long-term relationship. Reply if you are serious and interested. If you respond, please put, I want to diaper you in the subject line.
Oh my goodness.
This guy is like a grown man and he's just sitting in the corner with a diaper.
Well, maybe just a half a drink more. The neighbors might think. Say, what's in this drink? I wish I knew how to break the spell.
Take your hat, your hair looks so.
I ought to say no, 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 sir. At least I'm gonna say that I tried. I really can't say, but it's cold outside. Bum, bum, bum.
All right, I have the last and possibly the worst. In fact, it is the worst.
Okay.
The worst thing you could do on Valentine's Day is dumping them.
Oh, yeah.
So don't dump anybody on Valentine's Day because that's just not cool. Remember, even though it may just be another day to you, girls actually care about Valentine's Day. One day it will come back to bite you in the butt, because what goes around comes around. But seriously, if you dump anybody on Valentine's Day, odds are that you were having second thoughts about the relationship prior to this date, and you should have done something about it sooner, but you didn't.
Get ready for your new life as a flash mob organizer! That's right. You will gather groups of Gabby Goofballs to dance and sing and wear no pants on a train. You will find swarms of unsuspecting bystanders to amuse and amaze, causing them to smile or to be annoyed or become aware of the plight of the Madagascar whooping bird. At your best, you will be awesome and shared throughout the planet. At your worst, you will have an epic fail and be shared throughout the planet. You will make money either way by advertising for dating sites or pimple cream. But at the end of the day, you will definitely have fun. So enjoy your new life as a flash mob organizer. And thanks for playing Get a Life!
Oh my. Wow.
So Allie is going on a spring vacation.
That's right.
She's going down to Florida.
It's a trip through my school. It's a science trip going to Florida. I'll be in the, like, in around Key Largo, and we're going to see the Everglades. And basically the trip is to just study kind of marine biology, but we're also doing things like kayaking. We're going to be swimming with dolphins. We're going to go to a sea turtle hospital. There's going to be hiking, dissecting a squid, and then making calamari afterwards.
Really? Seriously?
Yes.
You're going to actually, I don't know how I feel about that.
I'm not going to make the calamari, but, like, we're going to dissect the squid, and then...
You're going to dissect this... Oh, are you actually going to kill the squid?
I don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah, because I don't know if I could eat something after I've killed it. In fact, I don't even like going into seafood restaurants.
I think the squid might already be dead if we're dissecting it, because we're taking the ink out of it, too, and they said that if you take it out a certain way, you can write with it like a pen.
That's what I hear. I need to know more about that ink thing, because I know some people, that's a delicacy. I think you could actually eat that stuff.
I don't know.
What was I saying? Oh, yeah, I have a problem going into seafood restaurants where they have the lobsters in the tank when you're sitting being called to your table, and you're looking at these things, looking at you through the glass.
And then lobsters on the menu.
This is a thing that I've been into lately. In order to avoid feeling bloated, you know, I go into Starbucks and I just ask for a handful of coffee beans. So they just give me the beans, and I just sit around and eat coffee beans.
Really?
Yeah. It's great.
Are those really coffee beans?
Yeah. Help yourself.
Ooh, coffee. You hear that?
Let me know when this gets annoying.
What? Oh, yes. Chewing? This has got to be really entertaining for the listeners.
It's just coffee beans without the coffee. I mean, without all the fluid.
Where are we, Allie?
Well, it looks as though we are ready to board the Titanic.
This is, we are on Southampton Dock in England.
Right.
Allie, should we go into the dining room?
We should. I think this would be appropriate for this next.
Let's go to the first class, dining room. Ooh. I don't think we're properly dressed for this, Allie.
No, I don't. I feel a little sloppy.
This is beautiful up here.
It is.
Look at all these fancy people.
Look at the nice view of the ocean, too, the windows. So I think the show knows that I've kind of, like, that I play piano and that I've kind of taught myself just a little bit and everything. And so I wanted to take professional lessons just because to make sure I'm using, you know, the right techniques and just to improve because, you know what I'm trying to say.
Yeah. Well, I've been hearing a big difference just throughout the house. I hear you practicing and it sounding really good.
Well, thank you.
Does that continue all summer?
Yeah, it's going to. So there's some songs every now and then where it's a little bit of a challenge, but that's kind of what I need because if you don't have a challenge, you don't improve at all whatsoever.
Right.
Yeah.
Why don't you play something for us?
All right.
That's nice. Very nice.
Thank you. That was the actual first, like, that was the first song that he gave me just to, you know, kind of see where I'm at, you know.
It actually sounded very good in the headphones. I put a little reverb on it and it sounded nice.
Cool. Thank you for that.
Yeah.
So that was minuets in G major, by the way.
Ah, okay. That was going to be my guess.
Wow. Yeah, you've come a long way from piano. Do you hear a difference in your playing?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Well, I've been doing lessons since then. So that's...
Well, now you're teaching them.
Yeah.
That's right.
That too. Yeah. So I've been on the flip side of that.
Wow. There's a lot to adjust, digest from that segment. A couple things that stood out for me. Yeah, so we did, that was the second version of A Christmas Carol that we did. Basically, it was a replay of the first one that we did the year before, but we just remade that one scene. Oh, I'm sorry, there are two parts that we changed. Since Dave wasn't part of the first version of it because we didn't find you yet, we redid it the second year, and we had all the narration done by Dave. And then we also redid that segment that you heard because the first time we did it, a couple of your friends' alleys were just terrible.
Well, I had a couple of my friends over, but it's really hard for, you know, a bunch of 11 or 12 year olds to be reading parts, you know, of like guys in the street, you know.
And I always wanted to play Bert. I think he's one of the greatest cinematic characters ever.
That's for It's a Wonderful Life. We're talking about A Christmas Carol.
A Christmas Carol.
Oh.
Yeah, so.
Boy, okay.
Yeah, so.
I'm not with you then. Right
but now. It's hard for 11 or 12-year-olds with really high-pitched voice. I mean, they all sound the same. You know, reading these parts meant for adult characters.
Yeah, so we decided to redo the scene where we're, like, picking over Scrooge's stuff, you know, after he died.
Mm-hmm.
And, mm-hmm. you know. Let's see, 11-11-11. Just a side note there, I just remember that was an 11-minute show we did back on 11-11-11.
That's right.
As we played that Spinal Tap scene there.
And now we're doing like 2+ hours long length of shows.
Yeah, see, the shows are a lot more, you know, far and few between now, but they're epic. They're like 2 hours, 3 hours long now. So we're making up for it. And let's see, we did the Titanic was one of my favorite shows. A lot of research went into that show, but we did it exactly 100 years to the minute of the...
To the minute?
I think a sheep is peeing.
I mean, I planned it out exactly. It's starting to really smell now.
I stepped it. Oh, okay.
There's a lot more piles here than when we showed up. Yeah, the Titanic thing was fun. It was kind of a history lesson. And
stepping back into time
and a love story.
Well, that's the spin on yeah. I don't know if you can call that a historical film.
I need some show notes here because I have something prepped here.
Christmas hit.
Oh, by the way, Philip did print out some lyrics to his new song.
Oh, yeah. Circulate it.
Yeah, if you guys want to take a look at those. There's a lot of thought that went into that.
I'm trying to... Is there something else that printed? Never mind. I've got it over here. So I noticed that you and Philip did that duet of Baby, It's Cold Outside. Have you guys heard about that?
That's really wrong when you think about it.
I know. On that. You guys have heard about the backlash against that song, the political correctness of the song?
Yeah, yeah. Basically.
A radio station polled it, I think.
The Me Too movement.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, basically saying that the male character in that song was almost like
he refused to leave. And she wanted them to
like
leave.
Overstepping his boundaries.
Well, not only that, but I think the woman was supposed to leave, but was always trying to bring the woman back, trying to do it against her will, so to speak, and like sort of imposing.
And what's in the drink?
Him. Yeah, what's in the drink? Yeah,
so date rape. But
I didn't want to use the term, but I was going to say that they treated the guy in that song like a proto rapist. He's going to do something. You can hear it in what he's singing there. He's going to do something, and we don't want to have any of that going on these days.
I actually read about like the origin of that song because I'm trying to think. It was like first released in the 40s or 50s,
something
I think.
Like
but back then, kind of the line people would say is, "Hey, what's in this drink?" Like it was a joke. People would just say that, so it wasn't like unique to just that song where she's asking what he put in her drink. It was just a joke, like, you know, having a good time. Say, what's in this drink?
Right? Yeah, that historical aspect is lost on the...
Just like in The Honeymooners when Ralph would say, bang, zoom.
I wonder how that would go over now.
Because it wouldn't go over at all.
No. But, I mean, that's the thing that's the problem with so many people that get so professionally offended is they never take in context.
That's right.
And that song should fit into that too, I think. I mean, nobody was thinking those things back then when it was written.
Right, yeah. Everything was good and wholesome back then.
So I found this online. People were saying, well, if we're going to ban that song, because there were some backlash against radio stations that would play it. One radio station actually went out of the way and did like, they played it straight for 48 hours, just
as
on a loop.
Protest.
Just a protest. But they were saying, okay, if we're going to ban that song, here's some other ones that we should be banning. So I saw Mommy Kissing Santa Claus because adultery, obvious. Mm-hmm. The Christmas song, open fire, pollution, folks dressed up like Eskimos, cultural appropriation.
Mm-hmm.
Holly Jolly Christmas, kiss her once for me, unwanted advances. White Christmas, racist.
Well, obviously.
Santa Claus is coming to town, sees you when you're sleeping, knows when you're awake.
Creeper.
Peeping Tom Stalker.
Mm-hmm.
Most wonderful time of the year. Everyone telling you to be of good cheer, forced to hide depression. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, bullying. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Forced gender-specific gifts, dolls for Janice, Jen in boots and pistols, guns for Barney and Ben.
Oh, yeah.
Of course.
Horrible.
Santa Baby, gold digger, blackmail. Frosty the Snowman, sexist, not a snow woman. Do you hear what I hear? Blatant disregard for the hearing impaired?
Well, you know what? It shouldn't be a snow woman. It should be a snow person.
Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Make the Yuletide gay. Wow. Just wow.
Yeah.
Jingle Bell Rock. Giddy up, jingle horse, pick up your feet. Animal abuse.
That's for sure. I hate that song for that.
PETA is after them.
That's right.
Mistletoe and Holly. Overeating. Folks stealing a kiss or two. How did this song ever see the light of day?
Speaking of mistletoe, there's a thing I heard recently that somehow mistletoe is kind of like bringing about unwanted advances, too.
You accidentally end up under one of those.
Yeah, and then you have to get kissed, and of course that's terrible because you're violating the person's,
bubble.
Remember when everybody used to just act like adults?
Nah.
Do you remember those days?
Vaguely, they're coming back to me.
Oh, I think I remember now.
You know, this list that you're reading, it reminds me of that WKRP episode where they addressed issues like these. Now, when we're talking about censorship, are we censoring words and obscene language, or are we censoring ideas?
That's a very good distinction that you bring up.
I think that line is getting a little bit more fuzzy.
I think so.
Mm-hmm.
Good point.
And the last one on the list was Winter Wonderland. Parson Brown demanding they get married. forced partnership. So actually, you know, they came out with a
political... I'm professionally offended by that.
Yeah.
There's a difference between just casually offended.
Yeah.
Amateur.
They came out with a politically correct version of Baby, It's Cold Outside. Now we know what's in the drink.
Well, that's good to know.
We'll find out.
Actually, they changed the words, what is this drink? And it's pomegranate LaCroix.
Oh, you gave it away.
I gave it away. I'm sorry. Here, let's just play a little bit. It's only a couple. It's less than 2 minutes.
I really can't say.
Wrong one. Oh, here we go.
I really can't stay.
Baby, I'm fine with that.
I've got to go away.
Baby, I'm cool with that.
This evening has been
hoping you get home
so very nice.
I'm glad you had a real good time.
My mother will start to worry.
Call her so she knows that you're coming.
And father will be pacing the floor.
Better get your car
up. So really I better scurry.
Yeah, no rush.
Should I use the front or back door?
Which one are you pulling towards?
The neighbors might think
that you're a real nice girl.
Say, what is this drink?
Pomegranate LaCroix.
I wish I knew how.
Maybe I'll help
to
you out.
Break this spell.
I don't know what you're talking about.
I have to say no, no, no,
you reserve
sir.
The right to say no.
At least I'm gonna say that I tried.
You reserve the right to say no.
I really can't stay.
Well, you don't have to.
Oh, but it's cold outside. I've got to get home.
Do you know how to get there from here?
Say, where is my car?
I'll go and grab it, my dear.
You've really been great.
We'll have to do this
yes,
again.
I agree.
How about the Cheesecake Factory?
We're bound to be talking tomorrow.
Text me at your earliest convenience.
At least I've been getting that
unless
bite.
I catch pneumonia and die.
I'll be on my way.
Thanks for the great night.
Bye.
Bye. Drive safe.
You know, I'm still offended by that version because he assumes that she doesn't know how to get home.
Also, he calls her a girl. I think that's kind of sexist, too.
Yeah, well, he can just mansplain the directions to her.
That's right.
While manspreading.
Well, I was going to say that. All right.
Okay.
I think we're getting too topical again. We got to back that off.
So we've got two more things lined up. We've got one more montage to play, and we've also got Allie and Thomas. What is Thomas's arrival time?
He's already here.
Is he really?
Yeah, he's talking with Granny Rose in the house.
Excellent. Okay.
Probably having a few cookies.
He's probably eating all the cookies.
Yeah, he's having the cookies while we're down here.
It's getting warm. And
with the sheep, the smelly sheep.
So here's what we're going to do. We are going to play the last montage, and while the montage is playing, we're going to get set up for the band. Sound good to me?
Okay. Yeah.
Sounds good to you?
Sounds good.
Great.
Okay. All right, last collage. So this is segment four. Oh, no, sorry. June 2012 all the way through October of 2018. So here we go. 25 wow. episodes over the course of 6 years. All right, so we'll be back very momentarily.
History is being made here today. You can tell your grandchildren that you were here at the first World Burping Championship.
Happy anniversary, baby.
The what? The turntable? What's that?
Happy anniversary, baby. Got you on my
mind. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
This brings it back, huh?
Going back on this one.
Little River Band. Going back to 1977 on this.
I'm so happy for you, baby.
We're just trying to kill the time until my wife gets down here.
Yeah, and I think I heard the phone ring.
I always liked Little River Band. They were kind of one of my guilty pleasures.
Yeah. I saw them at Naperville Rib Fest one year.
They had a great sound.
Good harmonies.
Beautiful melodies.
They had a lot of heartbreak. You could feel it in their lyrics.
Oh, yeah. They lived it, man.
You have an incoming call from Baba Gunish.
Baba. Baba's calling. Let me answer this call here.
Hello, everybody.
Hello, Baba.
Hello, Chris.
Hello, my good friend.
Yes, this is Baba Gunish.
I know who you are.
So I hear you are all by yourself this week.
That's right. Kim and Ellie are out of town.
How does it feel to be a bachelor again?
Not bad at all. I'm doing okay. I'm surviving okay.
Yes, I know. You have always been very self-sufficient, Chris. I knew you since you were a teenager and your parents were living away from the house and they left you alone a lot.
Yeah, that they did.
I always knew that you were very good at ironing and making food for yourself.
You have a very good memory.
Oreo marked her birthday this year with a pool party in a posh New Delhi neighborhood. You must ask who Oreo is.
Yeah, who names their kid Oreo?
Is it
not a human?
No, it is a two-year-old dog.
Oh.
The Dalmatian celebrated with a cake of flour, cheese, and chicken tikka. Garnished with a rib-shaped biscuit on top and spent the day splashing in a swimming pool and chasing her 20 canine friends at a sprawling dog resort.
Sounds like a good time.
Oh, it's a very good time. I wish I could have attended. However, Old Man Baba was not invited.
It's good to be back home again.
And all these people's stories remain a mystery. You casually walk by a woman with a painful history, and the man you just locked eyes with is a little girl dying. And you don't even know, you don't know these untold stories.
So lace up your thigh-high glitter boots, stitch up your bustier, and dust off your best Cat in the Hat fedora for the best time in town, the Smorgasbord 30th Anniversary Celebration at the Carlisle Ballroom in lovely Lombard, Illinois.
Thank you, Peet McCain. Hi, everybody. This is Chris, and I am here with my good friend and partner, Dave Jackson.
Hey, Chris. Nice to run into you. I'm actually here for the wedding next door, and I saw the 30th anniversary. Hey, Chris, I know that guy.
Yeah, good.
And I'm like,
good
why timing. Didn't he invite me? So I just kind of came over. I'm crashing your party. Sorry.
Thank you. You look fantastic in that tux.
Thank you.
Are you standing up in the wedding?
No.
Okay.
No, I am not standing up in the wedding. I'll be sitting down all the time.
Very good. Hey, this is a very, very big event. This is the 30th anniversary of the original Smorgasbord radio show that Dave and I did back in high school. Way back in the day at Downers Grove North High School, Downers Grove, Illinois. September 11th, 1982. Jeez, I have to go back a century almost, right?
30 years. Wow.
Wow. Where did the time go?
I don't know, but it's true that it just flies by.
What's that?
Would you look at that? It's Dave parachuting down to Earth.
Hey, that's a fantastic way of arriving. Dave!
Yeah. This is the most interesting entrance I've ever seen you.
hey, folks.
Always a show off, aren't you?
Yeah.
Oh, man. They dropped me off at the right place, at least.
You're never one to disappoint us.
I thought my latitude was off or something.
Yeah, we have a big German Shepherd next door outside. It would have been a little rough if it had been just a little further off.
A little more to the left and would have caused some damage.
Dangerous.
Wow.
Well, boy, it sure is great to see both of you.
Yeah,
you too.
You too.
I was at a conference.
You were?
Yeah.
I was learning how to do conferences.
It was a conference on how to do conferences?
Right.
Yeah,
right.
What did you learn?
Right. Well, you know, how to book guests and how to get the food and, you know.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Are you going
to
be
you don't even need a topic to do a conference anymore.
No.
You just say you're having a conference. People show up.
On how
up.
To do a conference.
Yeah.
I do a lot of webinars now. You know, somebody sends out a topic, a link, saying, hey, join me for a webinar. I'm going to tell you about this. And you say, hey, I could really use some knowledge on that topic. And you just sit there in your chair and click the link and you're involved. You're brought into the conference. If you had a time machine, would you prefer to go to the future or to the past?
Well, I don't know. I think as a little kid, I always would say the future because, you know, it's an unknown world and, you know, you imagine all these crazy things. But honestly, I don't think I would say the same thing now. I don't think I would want to go to the future. I think I would want to go to the past because, I don't know, I feel like we should never rush what's going to come. I want to be surprised on what's going to come. And, you know, it's, you know, sometimes I think it'd be fun to just go back and relive experiences or, and I'm not a person who would be stuck in the past all the time, but I wouldn't want to rush what's to come either.
Remember that old ghost story you told your sister when you were kids? The story about the dark man coming into your house and you upstairs in bed with your feet all tucked in the sheets. And now he's at the first step coming up to your room. And now he's at the second step. And now he's at the third step and the fourth step and the fifth. And now the horrid dark man is at the 12th step. And now he's opening the door of your room. And now he's standing at the foot of your bed. I can't stand it! There. What's that? At the bottom of the steps. A man under the light. Oh. Now he's gone.
Can you hear me now?
I'm sorry.
But you've got to hear me. Oh, please, you've got to help me. There's someone in this house. Someone is going to murder me. And you've got to get in touch with... Oh, there it is. There it is. Did you hear it? He's put it down. He's put down the extension phone. He's coming up. Oh, he's coming up the stairs. Give me the police department. The police department. Police department, give it to me.
One moment, please. I will connect you.
Oh, I can hear him. I can hear him. He's nearer. Oh, I hear him. I hear him. Hurry. 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 No. 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 No.
Police Department, Sergeant Martin speaking. Police Department, Sergeant Martin speaking.
You know it's true. Hope you need my love, babe, just like I need you. Hold me, love me. Hold me, love me. I ain't got nothing but love, babe, 8 days a week.
Neil's hands are trembling as he recognizes the handwriting and reads the return address on the envelope. The address of lovely Cynthia Walker. She's out of his life now. No, she'll never be out of his life. He's out of hers.
Hey, Allie.
Hi, what's up?
Hey, what's up?
How's it going, Allie?
I come downstairs and it smells like beer and pizza. So
smells like...
Okay. I know
there's no beer.
Oh, there's a glass there.
Hold on a second. There we go.
There's no beer because someone drank it all.
No, there's no beer in the house. No, I grabbed a little bit of wine because we were doing this jazz club atmosphere here.
Ah, you've got a nice vibe going on down here.
I'm in quite an embarrassing position, Philip.
How do you mean?
I seem to be the only one having a good time.
You and Mrs. Atwater.
What's going on, Philip?
Would you mind turning that lamp off?
Sorry.
I don't like the light in my eyes while I'm playing.
You know, Philip, I get quite intrigued when people don't answer questions, and quite curious.
Did you ask me a question?
Yes, Philip, I asked you a question.
Well, what was it?
I asked you what is going on here.
A party.
Yes, but a rather peculiar party. What's it all about, Philip?
What's what all about? Stop playing crime and punishment, Rupert. If you want to know something, come out with it. Otherwise...
Now, now, temper. Don't stop playing.
I'd like a drink.
I'll get it for you. Keep playing.
When you had your lipid panel, did you fast for that? You're supposed to fast for that test.
Both times. Both times.
Okay.
Listen to us. We sound like a bunch of old men.
Because they took...
We sound like a bunch of old men here.
We're not talking about her. With aches and pains.
With our medical... Yeah, well, when I got my blood test... it's only going to get worse from here, you know?
I tell you, when we were 25, we weren't talking about blood tests, that's for sure.
No, we were talking about...
and how we couldn't get any.
Philip, what is going on, my man?
Well, it's been a really crazy week, you could say.
Yeah, I can imagine. Tell me more, please.
You would not believe what I've been through. But let me just right off the bat tell you that this has all just been a misunderstanding. Everything has been taken out of context. I can assure you that.
I hope so, Philip, because we've been putting a lot of trust in you, and you know how I felt originally when Allie brought you home from the playground.
Well, see, my kind of character is one that's so easily misjudged, you know? No one has given the big picture. Everything's out of context.
Yeah, that's the problem. All I have is a big picture here of you, and it looks like they're hauling you away like a caged animal.
Well, if you're going to... use one of those pronouns that's not the normal he, she, let's say, then you just have to give someone a break. If they say the wrong thing, just say, I prefer to be called this
right
or that. And then from now on, they will probably.
Don't put the onus on me to have to find out first. So don't be offended if I use the wrong one, because to me, you look like a girl.
Yeah, you look like a girl. So I said she, and if you like to be called something else, then tell me. And then I will from now on.
When I was a preteen, people thought I was a girl because of my hair, and I didn't get bent out of shape. I mean,
true. But I think what we're dealing with in society, especially unfortunately with young people today, is that we're dealing with what we call an offense culture. People, or in other words, people are like want to be professionally offended. Mm-hmm. If you don't get something right, or if you misjudge it, or misguess, you're ready to jump on it and say, oh, you offended me. Oh, you are transphobic or whatever. And they will just find a reason
to be offended.
To be offended and to get twisted out of shape about it. And this is just another venue for this to be expressed.
A mouse can be can feel a little bit unintuitive at first. And then sometimes a touchpad, that sounds like really exciting, but it does the same job as the mouse. But it's like for laptops, where sometimes you don't want to carry around a mouse. And so the touchpad kind of helps you move your cursor around with a little touchpad. So you touch the pad and it moves around.
Oktoberfest. Yes. I wish I was in Munich.
So, this is something that I wasn't able to do when I had the show with Allie when she was 11. But now that the Smorg Show has pretty much morphed into my own creation without a concern about being family friendly, I can do Oktoberfest now with my good friend Jerry.
Prost!
Prost!
Let's get the clink.
Let's get the clink. Yes.
Yeah.
Haha.
Sehr gut.
I was trying to combine. I've been making a lot of videos lately because I'm trying to find work as a video editor. And so that was on my mind. And then you said you wanted to do the next podcast with the three of us together. Mm-hmm. So your brain just put two things together. Nice. And I thought, well, but the three things, actually, because Jerry and I have been doing some hiking lately.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right.
My doctor tells me I got to keep walking. Mm-hmm. And Jerry loves to hike, so we put it all together. And then I remember you mentioning that we should all hike. This was like a year ago you said this.
Yeah.
And I just put
all those things together.
Wow, you went way back there in a year
and
ago.
I just came up with this idea. Why don't we just do the podcast in the woods?
That's a great idea, Dave. Why don't we? Here we are. Now what do we talk about?
Top 10 K-pop, sexiest K-pop
singers,
boy group.
Not safe for work. See, but now they sing, I think they're singing in some English there.
Yeah.
That's the one thing that K-pop is kind of known for, bouncing between the two languages.
Yeah, it's kind of like my grandma's church when I used to go. They would talk Slovak or Polish, yeah. And then they'd throw in a few English words every now and then just to keep you interested in the conversation.
Yeah. What?
Oh. It's like, oh, I know that word. Rubbing their crotches here.
Cross gene.
It's very Michael Jackson to them, this video.
Well, you know. Again, nobody would ever say that necessarily K-pop's particularly original either. Just sort of very visually loud.
Yes. WDGC, 88.3 FM.
Oh, wait, this is FM? I thought this was AM.
Is it? How you doing, Dave?
I'm doing okay. Do you realize... the last time you and I actually spoke into these probably same microphones.
It looks like it. I see the. I recognize the masking tape.
They smell the same.
They do.
We haven't been on this radio station in. Well, you're real good with the computing of the numbers.
34 years.
34 years. That's what I was going to say.
August 17th, 1984 was the last time.
And he knows the date. Wow.
Yeah, I don't know why I've got that talent to remember those milestones. All right. Are you guys down here with me?
Somebody's down here. Sounds like somebody's got indigestion.
Yeah, I know. Who's got the bad breath? Okay. Well, that's all I have.
Okay.
This is the Halloween episode. Welcome to it. Hey, it's a spook fest.
Happy Halloween.
Have a good day. All right. Well, that concludes our historical retrospect.
I just wanted to say one thing that you were talking about, how the setup was over at your old high school radio station. No, it was all of our high school radio station. I guess that's not the way to say it. But anyway, WDGC. And I just realized, actually, the Smorg studio down here is better set up than the station we did our thing at.
Minus the cows.
Minus the cows.
We didn't have cows back then.
No, we had other things, which I won't get into, but that's neither here nor there. I'm just saying that the setup is better than their high school station.
You might be right about that, even now. I mean, absent the transmitter, although even now I don't think I would even brag about the transmitter. It wasn't even working when we were doing our 50th reunion.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And their current transmitter is about the size of a briefcase.
Yeah, I could basically install it here if they gave it to me.
Smaller than, than your rack rider.
Right. Hey, Chris, nice rack.
Nice rack. Allie went up into Granny Rose's barn or house, connected house.
Well, she's getting some cookies. I mean, I would do that.
Well, she's tuning up because they're going to be coming back here and doing some songs. But to your point, though. Yeah, I'm looking around here. I think that's probably the biggest thing that has evolved since we started this thing is just how elaborate this place has become.
Wow. I mean, look how WKID has changed over the years.
WKID.
WKID.
98.7.
Was that the number?
Yeah, I think it was. I think there was another station.
Yeah, you've got to make up your own frequency, too, if you make up your own radio station.
Right.
I didn't realize WFMT had, like... Was it FMT? Was it 98.7?
Yeah.
Classical station. Yeah, it was...
You weren't playing classical, that's for sure.
No. I think I changed my frequency at some point when I realized that, so...
thing I wanted to slip in here is that I wanted to say I appreciate all the work that went into this project. All the editing, all the parts that you put together.
Oh, for today.
Yeah, for today. Amazing. Oh. Really, really nice work on
Thank you.
Nice job. Mm-hmm. And also, it's helping me to get a feel for all the shows that I missed.
That's
because now I can see a real progression through the years. Seems like we just keep getting a little bit better. Slowly.
Yeah.
But we're getting better.
Another 100 will be right on target.
Another 100 episodes, yeah. We'll be ready.
And at the rate they're going, it'll be let's see, another 100 episodes.
2030?
Yeah, probably. Maybe I was 2035.
Well, we picked it up. Now we're doing 10 a year. So, okay. Yeah, about another 10 years, we'll be right there for 200.
There you go.
My goal is to, I don't think I could beat The Simpsons, but maybe I could beat Seinfeld. How many episodes did Seinfeld have? 200 something? I don't know.
Yeah.
But, because you joined somewhere around episode 39 or 40, and...
Yeah, and I never heard the earlier ones, except for little clips you've played for me now and then. So...
Well, you know, they're on the website. You could just
got to hear everything. Yeah, I could have done that. I could have done that.
Brushed up on your history before coming here.
But I kind of liked it that you did all the work.
Yeah. Nice. Boiling it down to the best. You know, like when they show a movie trailer and they get the best bits out of the entire movie and they boil it down into the 2-minute trailer and then you're disappointed in the rest of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably better that you heard the 100 episodes boiled down to, you know, like an hour.
Yeah. Yeah. When you watch a movie trailer, so, you go, well, I'm definitely not going to go see this movie because these clips are not very good.
Well, sometimes it's the best. It's the only like funny lines. They put it in the trailer. And then you go see the movie and you're like, this is nothing like the trailer.
I think that's
no refunds, pal.
That's right. Yeah. No, it's sort of a Reader's Digest version of your podcast career.
Down from 9 years into...
Yeah.
Now, this was a lot of fun putting this together. It really gave me a chance to go back because I had to fish out 30 seconds or so of each episode and trying to find, how do I tell a story that kind of tells us where we've been and really highlights some of the first time that we did certain things, bring those out.
Well, that's what's so great too about recording is that you've got a way to get your milestones in order. Get your milestones in order. No,
I'm still working on that.
Right, because then you can move on to a new chapter in life, and then it gives you a sense like, okay, this chapter's over, now we're moving on to something else.
Yeah.
Before, you know, we only had photographs at one point. Before that, what did people do? Sketched on the cave wall, I guess.
Chipped a marble.
Yeah, we killed a buffalo. Okay, remember that? Yeah.
Yeah, there it is. I'm wearing the hide right now.
Yeah, I'm just looking back on the 25, the last 25, and really the highlights. I think this is when you guys started coming around more consistently, and we started making more of the show ourselves because Allie was starting to get more into her thing, starting in high school. Obviously, social life picks up, and then college, and of course, then she drops off the planet. So I really appreciate you guys coming out because it really kept this thing going. And I feel like it took a different, it evolved into something new.
Yes. Plus it's helping us all find a way to exercise the radio bug that we all seem to have and we'll never lose. It's a way to do it in a fun way. And it's, it's low pressure. It's not, we're not doing it for money. It's just for fun.
That's right.
And you get the best results that way, I think.
Well, I mean, it's funny you should talk about the radio bug because, I mean, when we were listening to radio and got into radio, that animal, that entity known as radio was a lot different than what you're hearing nowadays. And I think that's why things like podcasting, that sort of outlet is really growing so much because if you go back... Yeah, it was always corporate. It was always kind of big business to some extent, but there was some level of personality. It was still kind of in there. You could still hear elements of creativity would pop through. I mean, obviously, with the whole thing in the 80s with the advent of personality radio, you know, Steve Dahl, Howard Stern, that whole thing, and that was good, but they've clamped down on it. It's not there anymore at all. I mean, it is so... pre-programmed now. It's like the pop music that's out now. It's just so calculated for a particular market, for a particular... They've gotten their wish. They have totally, basically destroyed any of the creative outlet for pretty much almost all radio except for maybe college radio.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe you hear something interesting in NPR.
You might say it's been homogenized.
Yeah, I would... Mm-hmm. Homogenized would probably be a good word for it. I would just say... just killed the creative soul of radio.
Yeah.
It's just gone. Mm-hmm. So something like this, this outlet, I mean, I'm kind of going a little tangent because I'm known for that. But the point of this tangent is to say that you've come back and we have something like the Smorgasbord podcast. And it allows people, and other podcasts too, but the Smorgasbord podcast in particular, it allows a certain level of imagination to still be expressed. As I said, what the heck are they doing back there?
I don't know.
Anyway,
see, I know. A lot of noise going on back there.
Yeah. Anyway, that thing is allowed to happen here in regular media, and it's not just TV and radio, but I mean they're even trying to crack down places like YouTube. But the thing is, podcasting and what you're doing here is really still keeping that thing alive, and I think that's really important. And people kind of forget that. So people listen to the show, you're getting something here that you're not going to get from other outlets for the most part. So this is something that you should really appreciate.
I'm going to turn that into a commercial. Thank you.
You're welcome.
You read it like I wrote it.
And if you don't, we'll come after you.
Damn it.
No, but this whole thing about podcasting, thinking back 9 years ago, I mean, podcasting was already kind of underway, but I was still learning it as a new medium. I didn't really know exactly how. I mean, you can see my Podcasting for Dummies book is still here on the shelf.
Well, I mean...
I thought that was just for me. I thought you wanted me to see that.
Yeah, you need to catch up on something, Dave.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I forgot I brought my bookshelf out to the barn. Because it's, you know, you never know when you might need the podcasting book out here at the barn.
But it's a pretty cool thing. Like I said, having this ability, I mean, podcasting isn't just the only thing because they do have internet radio too, but internet radio is a lot more of an involved undertaking. There's a lot more to it. Doing a podcast, you can kind of encapsulate what you want to get. And by the way, it's always there. It's always like a renewable resource. The thing is, with the stuff that we heard, like, unless you heard tapes, had tapes later on, and somebody taped the shows back then, those DJs and those personality people, that's gone. It's an ether.
Yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
Whereas podcasts, you can go back to and you can get something.
Yeah,
and say, hey, I love that. You can listen. Hey, let's do it again.
Yeah.
So I think that's a good thing.
Exactly.
It's on demand.
Yeah. On demand creativity.
All right, well, we are in the winding down stage of the show, and we are going to bring on Allie and Thomas. They call themselves Wanderlove, and I don't know exactly where they got their name from. I guess they like to spread love wherever they go. I don't know what.
Wherever they wander.
I forgot that they had a band name before that, and they realized that somebody else already had it, so they were forced to change it. I need to find out. So, can I play a commercial? Do we have a commercial? Do we have anything?
I want a promo.
A promo. Let's see if we could find an old promo. Or we could just... We could always do the shower. That's always a good thing. We'll be right back. Smorg Show Podcast, episode 300. Oh, no. Sorry, 100. Wishful thinking.
The next time you're in the shower and Chris and Dave stop in, say the Smorg Show podcast is going to make me rich. And win.
Hello. Okay, we are just seconds away from some fantastic entertainment. And I've got some reverb going here. Why is that? Oh, yeah, because we're in a rock environment here. Hey, Allie and Thomas, welcome to the studio. Or the barn. Sorry. Welcome to the barn.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
This is, what do you call yourselves?
We are Wanderlove.
And how did that name come about? I believe you had to change your name from something else before, wasn't it?
Yeah, we used to be called Forever Endeavor. So like Forever, then Endeavor is like, oh, going on an endeavor or something. But we found out that it was copyrighted and trademarked, so we decided, okay, we don't want to get sued, so we'll just look elsewhere. And I think the name kind of originated from, you know, Wanderlust, from, you know...
Travel junkie.
Exactly.
But the difference between Wanderlust and Wanderlove is, instead of just being, oh, you just get a high from traveling, Wanderlove is like falling in love with all the places you go and the people you meet along the way.
Nice.
Yeah.
So you're going to play a cover, and you're going to do an original.
Yes.
And what is your cover?
It is Tell Her You Love Her by Echo Smith.
All right.
This is for you, Jerry. I know you're an Echo Smith fan.
Yeah. Sounds good. Okay, so I see you're holding an iPad here. So do you need some help? Because you have to play a guitar also.
I'm not doing it for this song.
Oh, okay. You're just singing.
For next one, we might need some help, but for this one, we should be good.
Okay, well, take it away whenever you're ready.
Okay, ready?
Mm-hmm. Tell her a story and tell her the honest truth. You treat her better, make sure to see it through. Don't be just everything she wants, be everything she needs. When she says she loves you, tell her you love her too.
Very nice. Excellent.
Thank you.
So,
we're just setting up for our setting up
this. You've got a new original.
This is an original, yes.
And a little bit of a backstory behind this song is actually we were trying to make fun of those movies, like there's like a drama movie and it has like some kind of soft kind of indie song.
Folky song.
And then while we were doing that, we kind of stumbled upon our own and like, hey, let's keep it.
We were playing the guitar for it and we're like, oh, it sounds like someone's traveling down a dirt road right now. And then it actually developed into a song.
Okay. Funny things. All right.
Come to the river, my dear. stuck so tight in your dreams, I'm running wild to the soaking edge. Come near. Run to the end of the bridge where you take for granted lives you never lived. Can't face the day, 'cause you can't keep me away. Your aching heart just wants to give. Walk through the garden of faith. You thought you were living, but to live is just too late. Said you needed time. Well, your time has now arrived. Lock the door and close the gate. Crawl to the earth to me. Lay your spirit down underneath. When you your consequences, I will set you free. 'Cause I'm the only voice you need.
Very nice. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having us.
Pleasure.
So I think it's time to close out here. We've been at it for 3 hours. This has been a good time, guys. Dave, Jerry, thank you for coming. They've been crowded out by the mics. And this is the barn. Where's the closing music? Yeah, this is appropriate. I don't know. Allie, thanks for this journey that we've been on for 9 years.
I know, and I can't believe it's been 9 years. And it's been even longer for you guys.
Yeah, it has. I can't even count the years anymore. Oh, my back. I can feel it already. Smorgasbord Radio Show, SmorgShow Podcast has evolved so much over the past 37 years, and I want to thank Dave for making it possible. Jerry has been an important contributor over the years. Allie, of course, in the second iteration of this 9 years ago, you've been an amazing partner for me.
It's been such a journey, and it's funny that every episode we were, you know, saying the number of every episode, and we finally hit the triple figures. It took 9 years to do it, but
I don't know. I don't have any more strength. It's going to take a little while for me to do the next one, but this one took a lot out of me. Thank you very much. We'll just close this out, and we'll be back for another episode very soon. Take care.